Check this out. She's a little unhappy. This is Peanut, the new blind kitten. So I had her, she's a little, yeah, a little unhappy. Well, Rusty, our semi-feral cat with a personality problem that we've had for about a year here that just, you know, still working on him. He's a work in progress. He's around here someplace, and she's not happy about it. How are you doing, Peanut? There's a lot of mouse in Peanut. Okay, let you go. I'm so out of time. It's almost New Year's Eve. Tomorrow's going to be a very busy day. I've had a family, I'll call it a family urgency, not even an emergency, but family stuff that has kept me from doing very much ham radio now since a little before Christmas. Decorations are still all up here. New Year's Eve begins in, you know, the day of New Year's Eve begins in a few minutes. Check this out. Tempted to go, wrong show. But I got this in the mail a couple weeks ago. A gift from the producer of The Last Man Standing television show, John Amodeo NN6JA. And so I tossed him some email and said, thank you for the shirt. Hey, would you like to come on the show? And squeezed into all of this time that I don't have for doing things. I mean, I haven't even shaved. It's just, there's no time. I've got no time. Wasn't that a Star Trek episode theme? Squeezed in there somewhere. I talked to John for almost 3 hours. And so this is Ham Radio Now, episode 288. John Amodeo, Unplugged. It's like a almost 3 hour verbal acoustic concert with John. John's been on all the other shows. He's told a good deal of the story of how ham radio has been incorporated into The Last Man Standing, and to some extent, how it can't be more than it is. But in 2 and almost 3/4 hours, we get into more, guaranteed. Let's see. Let me do this here. Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. Arvin back there, still wearing the Santa Claus hat, invites you to stop by hamradionow.tv and kick in something to help us keep on going. Patreon for a monthly contribution, credit cards or PayPal for an individual contribution. Been a pretty good year. I haven't even had time to add up what we did this year, but it's been okay. I mean, not greatly better than any previous years, but not worse. So we're holding our own. So thank you very much, everybody who has contributed. $100 contribution came in earlier today. I'm not going to tell you from who, but it did. Very nice. It made my day. If not my year, but it made my day. All right. So we're going to talk about all kinds of things involving the show and John and television and ham radio media in general, as you might imagine in something this long. So a couple things about that. Toward the end of the program, we talk about something that John mentioned in an email afterwards that said, if you haven't done the introduction, maybe you could toss this in toward the beginning, because we only cover it at the very end when, you know, nobody's still watching. And oh, by the way, some of the best stuff is in the last 15 minutes. So if you don't watch the whole thing, scoot down there and we'll catch the end. And what he wanted me to toss in was that please don't send him ideas for incorporating ham radio into the show, into Last Man Standing. Please don't. Some hams have had pretty good ideas, and a lot of hams have had terrible ideas. But the problem is not that a lot of hams have had terrible ideas. The problem is if you send him an idea, he can't use it, and he can never do a show based on that topic. So if you send him one of the best ideas for a ham radio element that could really work in Last Man Standing, And he'll talk about why most ham radio things would not work and why the show can't be more ham radio-ish than it already is. But if you just happen to come up with that gem of an idea that the writers could incorporate, and it would be great, it would be funny, it would be understandable to the audience, everything would be wonderful, he can't use it for legal reasons, because then you could come on and say, I sent that idea, send me $1 million. We'll talk about that. So please don't do it. And then maybe we'll get another ham radio story in there. The other thing about the program being this long is that this is an ideal candidate for listening to and not watching, because it's about 97% talking heads. So you'll see John, you'll see me. I toss in a few clips here and there, but you'll still get most of what they're all about just from listening. So if you've never listened to a Ham Radio Now podcast, if you've got a smartphone, it's the ideal way, but you can get them on the computer. Tell you what, let me dial up the website. If I can control my computer here. Yeah, there's the website. When you get here, click on the click to enter. It'll be in a different spot depending on what kind of browser you're using, if you're on a phone or whatever. This is a Squarespace site. It is adaptive, so it reorients itself. So you look at just about any episode of Ham Radio Now, and there'll be this little thing here for listening to the audio, and you can just play it there, or you can download it. But even better is you can subscribe to the audio and get it on a smartphone, a tablet, whatever, and get them automatically whenever we show up. So if you've got a smartphone device, it's got a podcast app, it'll probably find us just by typing in Ham Radio Now. As one word, as three words, should be able to find it and find the podcast. Let me see what that looks like here on this phone. So here it is in the list of podcasts. There's some of the other ham radio-oriented things and some of the other stuff that I listen to. So there's the Ham Radio Now. And if I open it up, you'll see some of the recent episodes. And I even make some art specifically for the episodes. Okay, so that's the way to do it. Subscribe. Now, if your phone can't find it for some reason, then go to this page, our audio page, and it'll give you instructions on how to enter something. There's the code for entering right into the phone. So listen to it. Okay, I've said everything I need to say before we get started, because I don't want to make this a 3.5-hour show. It's the longest show I think I've ever done. So let me switch to the Skype line and let's talk to John. So on the Skype line is John Amodeo, NN6JA. John, you are the producer of Last Man Standing. Still producer, or are you executive producer? Do you own the show?
Well, yet? It's a long and difficult story. I'll try not to make it hard. I'm what actually is called the line producer, although my title and my credit is co-executive producer.
Best food in the world, pizza. But Denver doesn't have pizza, not real pizza.
And I'm also the unit production manager, or UPM, which is a Directors Guild of America designation.
Okay, because there's been, in the media in general, the big question, what does a producer do? So maybe we'll find out about that. There are, and you've been on a lot of the shows. You've been on just about everybody's show, but this one so far. So I'm glad to finally round out your tour of media.
You can ask me all the questions that no one else asked.
That's my goal.
Good.
And
maybe I can answer that. I'm not sure. We'll see.
Yeah, you answer what you can, and I understand, because there are some things that get proprietary or just delicate. And
I want to say there'll be no shameless production for my television show.
Wait a minute. Let me get that full screen here. Okay. Stick it right in the camera.
Oh, okay.
And the sign behind you. is
cool too. Now that's, I've never noticed that before.
Friday at 8 p.m. on ABC. And I might add, it is, you're going into your sixth, you're in the middle of the sixth season.
We're dead in the middle of the sixth season.
You are available for five seasons on Netflix and a bunch of the others. But if anybody's got Netflix, they can watch the first five seasons.
And we're now nationally syndicated. So it's a little bit like the I Love Lucy scenario where it's just on somewhere, everywhere in the country.
Yeah. You're on 11 o'clock at night. Every night, stripped every night. And that happens at starting at about what season? You got to get enough in the bank.
Yeah. That starts at about 100 episodes is when they start looking to syndicate. And we hit that in the beginning-ish of season five. And they got us into sort of a limited syndication initially, which was Country Music Television, ABC Family, and I think the Hallmark Channel, I think. And then, so that's sort of a small syndication package. And then this year we went national. So that is, we're in every market in the country, different times, different days. So I flip around my TV and I see it all the time. And I'm like, you know.
Yeah. Do you make residuals? I know actors do. I don't know if folks at your level get anything out of that deal.
There's a small amount of residual pool based on the Directors Guild component of my employment.
Okay. It buys Christmas presents for people maybe a little bit.
Yeah, let me turn down whatever that was in the back. I've got three or four radios on that I turned most of them down by now.
Ham radio noise in the background is never a problem on a show like this. So what I'd like to cover, I think, four things if I can remember what they were. Talk about the show and what the show is, and then the ham radio component of the show. And then ham radio in media in general, that I think you've been observing for a long time. And then finally, this guy here on my, punch the right button on my screen. That's you. You sent me a lot of background information. Turns out we've crossed. And also, by the way, I don't know what buttons to push here. So I screw things up like crazy. We've had a lot of background in common. We've both been video editors and you're a private pilot. And are you still active in flying?
Not for a while. It's gotten a little too busy.
Yeah.
But I did enjoy it. It's one of those hobbies that takes you away from everything else. When you're flying, you really can't think too much about anything else.
Yeah. I got my private license when I was 19, and I flew for a few years. And then things got both too busy and too expensive. And I found out I took a check ride, and then the next entry in my log was the next check ride a year later. And I said, I'm not a safe pilot, so I'm not going to fly anymore. At least, but
from
I'm
the
always
days of been, the. The days of the $25 an hour rental plane are over.
Yeah. Yeah. Back then I was paying, I was in a club, so I was paying $7 an hour for a 150 or 12 for a 172 and another $7 an hour for an instructor. 1969. So yeah, I could afford that as a broke high school student and not as an employed, whatever I am. But you're right. It's a lot of fun. Let's talk about the show a little bit. Last Man Standing is a sitcom. The first season that I watched it, I was attracted to it because there was a lot of publicity about the ham radio component to it, which we'll talk about more of that in a little bit. Mm-hmm. So all I watched for was, well, when's the ham radio stuff? Okay, there it is. Go, cool, there it is. There, yeah. And I was watching today as I was working out and picking up in the seasons that I'd missed. And because I watched continuously season one, season two. And then I was a cord cutter. So I don't see appointment television anymore. I got to go look at it and it's got to be online before I can really see it. So I'm watching the beginning of season three. And I said, well, I know I noticed this stuff, but it didn't really dawn on me. The connections with past shows. And I'm saying, you know, what I'm seeing a lot in here is two shows that have family in their name, All in the Family and Family Ties. You got, Tim Allen is not in the vein of a Neanderthal quite, but he's, you know, he's a little throwback or on the he's conservative.
He's
surrounded by a family that is mostly not, although he's got one daughter that's kind of following in his footsteps. And so that mix from All in the Family and Family Ties is driving a lot of the drama. It's not really a drama, but the drama of the program.
Yeah.
Am I seeing that right? Is that?
Yeah, I think the comparison to All in the Family is absolutely right, because the Mike Baxter character is very much like the Archie Bunker character. You know, he's super conservative and living in what at least was perceived to be for a while as a more liberal world. So Mike is sort of picking his way through the liberal world and making his statement about how he thinks life should be lived. But, you know, can we go back for a minute, because we can segment however you want to segment.
We can go anywhere you want. And
all right. Here, the first thing would be, I don't know. You tell me. It's like, what's really more important about Last Man Standing? Last Man Standing is a family comedy. That's sort of when people say, what's the show about? It's a family comedy. And
it's got a social element in it.
It does. So, I mean, because we can get to the ham radio thing, which is really the smallest possible slice of of what the show is. And, you know, I can explain that even mathematically. So, it's a family show. Every week, the writers strive to write a really fun, sort of compelling family comedy where Mike Baxter and his wife, Vanessa, deal with issues that deal with the family. So in that regard, it's like every other family comedy that you can think of that you've seen. So it's a classic family comedy. You know, it is very traditional. In fact, I hesitate to call it retro, but it fits more into that category than into something modern, since I said the word modern, like Modern Family, where you've got a highly blended, multicultural, if you want to say multigender family. So we're just a real conservative family comedy.
And the title of the program, and then sort of the way it's constructed, being Last Man Standing, it's a guy in a family of all women. And that's sort of the way things started out, but I don't see that as being a big element of the show anymore.
Yeah, it's changed. In the brief history of the show, it has changed considerably because the writing staff changes. And when the writing staff changes, oftentimes the underlying theme of the show changes. So it was originally, just as you suggest, it was originally created to be Mike Baxter, surrounded by women, and in the greater world, surrounded by more or less liberal people who don't, as far as he's concerned, don't know how to live their lives. And then he had this grandson, Boyd. And the basic concept of the show was, how would a grandfather teach his grandson how to live in this world that is surrounded by women and, for the most part, inept, liberal type people who can't hunt or camp or fish or provide for themselves in any kind of a crisis or emergency?
Yeah. In other words, most of us.
I think, most urban families. And then, of course, over the years, you start writing those stories and you see, how does that work? And or can we make something that's better or more interesting? And I think the writers take on that challenge and the show evolves and or transforms into whatever that particular year's writing teams make it.
So it is, most primetime shows don't make it into six seasons, and you're getting stronger. Your ratings are getting better and better. So what is it that's made this show do what it's doing? Well, and where's that success coming from?
What made it stay on the air was, I think, the magic of Tim Allen, to be quite honest. And then again, what keeps any show on the air is good writing. You know, good writing first, probably good acting second, and then everything else third, budgetary direction, all of those things. And I think without Tim Allen, I don't know that we would have made it out of season one. And then once we made it out of season two, we started to catch a little heat. And then three and four were better. Five was fantastic. Six is turning out to be a great season. We were the highest rated scripted show on Friday night for the last several weeks in a row. We're hovering at about 8 million viewers right now, which on a Friday night is pretty impressive. You know, Friday night's demographic is people that don't go out of their house on Friday night.
Right. So you live in a date.
Yeah. It means you're not, you're in a family relationship and you have children or whatever, but you're not going out to a bar or a club or a restaurant. You're staying home and watching television at 8 o'clock, that's when most people would be in a bar or a club or a restaurant.
Do you see an age demographic? Is that something you can talk about?
Yeah, I mean, I see the demographic breakdowns as a part of the ratings, and it's certainly a show that skews older. And I don't mean by that entirely senior citizen, but more grounded family, 40, 50, 60s, and surprisingly more female than male. I would have thought the ratings would have showed me, you know, a lot of male viewers tuning in to see Tim Allen recreating the role of the tool man from Home Improvement. But a lot of women like the show, and that's because of the family aspect of it. And it is a pretty safe family show to watch. You know, you could watch the show with your grandmother and your kids, and no one will be offended or challenged by what we're saying, I don't think.
Yeah, and I'll agree with you that Tim Allen carries a lot of the burden in bringing people into the program to begin with, because I enjoyed Home Improvement. I like his character. His politics and mine are, you know, like 100%, 180 degree opposites. But the character's politics. I don't know about Tim's personal.
Sure.
But we've also seen very strong actors try to carry into new programs that failed. I'm thinking the Frasier character from Cheers, and then made it into his own show, and then tried a couple more shows that just went no place. So there's no guarantee that a strong actor is going to pull things through.
Oh no, it's very hard. I mean, you know, television is magic. It's you know, Friends is the best example, where all of the Friends actors have tried and or are currently trying a TV series, but they may not achieve the same success that Friends had, which, you know, one of the most highly rated shows on television, because you can't really put together the elements. No one can say mathematically you need these things in this order to make a TV hit show. Can't do it.
If anybody knew that magic formula, there would all be all good TV shows and all good movies. And most are terrible.
Most are terrible. Or, you know, not for lack of trying, you know, you can put the similar elements together and hope for the best and support it as best you can, but it doesn't mean it's going to be a hit show. And people will often give you three viewings, and if they're tuning out from it, the network will generally take that off the air because it's too expensive to run a TV show that no one's watching.
Yeah. And my taste run to sci-fi and maybe, you know, some of the police procedurals, things like that, action type stuff. But I really like watching the show. It is fast paced. It is very funny. And the characters are compelling. You know, all the things that you would say that you add together to make a show that people like watching. So,
thank you for saying that. That's wonderful to hear.
And you had mentioned a little bit earlier that one of the key elements was writers. And so we've got writers, we've got directors, producers, and the talent as sort of a four. Am I missing any major category?
Well, on the creative side, that's probably right. You know, there's a layer of producers that do various things based on their title and employment, you know, requirements. And it's the producers that get the show on the air and sell the show and then keep the show on the air. But it is really, it all starts in television, especially with writing. You know, the actors are very smart, funny people, but the words that come out of their mouth are not words that come out of their own imagination. Someone or some group of people, and in my case, it's a very big writer's room. I think I have 18 people in the writer's room right now, which probably sounds like a big number, but when you consider we have to write 22 episodes, it's not so big. And they write, you know, funny stories first, a funny story outline, and then they take that story outline and inflate it into a script. You know, and then what makes it really challenging, even more so than a dramatic show, is it has to be funny. So it has to be, you know, in a way, everybody that's seen sitcoms know that formulaically, every third or fourth thing someone says has to get a laugh, right? So that has to happen, you know?
And you have a live audience.
We have a live audience, yeah.
Do you enhance the laugh track at all, or do you rely entirely on the audience?
No, actually, we reduce I can explain a little bit because what's nice about your audience being hams is they will know enough about audio technology and editing technology. So when you shoot a show like this, you shoot multiple takes. You know, you may shoot at least three takes of each individual scene, sometimes more. And then what you're looking for in the editing room is the best performance from each individual line from the script. So an editor will listen to each line from the script and put together the compilation of the best takes. And that may give us somewhere in the neighborhood of several thousand individual edits. Now, regarding the laugh track, naturally, the audience is not going to laugh the exact same way each time they hear a joke. So when you're editing from take one of one particular line to take four of the continuation of that line, there's going to be a difference in the level of the audience presence, the quality or the size of their laugh or the duration of their laugh. So what you have to do besides just editing their audio together is you do often have to go on top of their laugh with a, I don't want to say a fake laugh track, but it really is, it's digital samples of our own audience. And then you can smooth out that edit point. So it's what you're hearing is predominantly our live audience reacting to the show live in real time. But then through the editing process, we are smoothing out those edit transitions, sometimes with a little laughter that has to go over the edit point. I hope, and I think your audience will understand that because they probably get editing better than most audiences.
So we'll talk a little inside baseball. When the when you do a second or a third take, it's the same audience. They've heard the joke already, so they're not going to react so much.
That's exactly right. The audience will come in our show, we shoot on Tuesday nights. They come in at 6 o'clock. They're warmed up by a warm-up comedian, and they listen to music with a DJ, and then the show starts promptly, and they watch multiple takes of each scene. So absolutely, they're reacting to each scene differently because they're hearing it for the first time. They've never heard it before. The second time, they've heard it, and now they probably understand the joke better or understand the timing of the joke better. And then the third time, they probably are like, oh, we've heard this one already. So they may not respond as well. So the editing process straightens all of that out for us. But we're really interested in the performance of the actors on stage, and then we'll figure out what to do with the laugh track later. But what you're hearing is live people laughing at the show, not some what people like to call canned laughter from people that are long since dead.
So if a joke never gets a laugh in any take, do you add a laugh to it or do you fire the writer?
But more likely, because the writers are with us when we're shooting, it's more likely that the writers would do a quick confab and change the joke, and then someone would run in and give the actors a different line. We'd shoot it again in front of the audience, and that usually gets a big laugh because now it's a surprise. Now it's a whole new line they've never heard, so they'll get us a good reaction usually.
Yeah. Hey, it's writing on the fly. That's
writing on the fly.
That's pretty amazing. So two things. I want to go back to the writers because I was going to ask you about them, but I have to apologize to my fellow editors and audio people and cameramen and directors and technical directors and all of the all of the people doing that, because I didn't include you in the list of people that I thought made the program work, and all those people make the program work. But it starts with it. I was going to say it starts with the writers, and you have preempted me by already agreeing with that. Mm-hmm. If you don't have something good to start with, right, you can't make a silk purse out of it.
There's no way to argue with that. The first thing someone does when one creates a sitcom is to sit down and write a story, and then they take that story and they inflate it into a script. And that script has to be entertaining and funny, and that is a multi-level challenge. I mean, it is, you know, it takes the accumulation of knowledge of that particular person and their knowledge about just drama, especially because even a comedy has drama in it, and then how to mathematically arrange the words so that every third or fourth line, it will make you laugh. That is a hard thing to do, and our writers do it very well.
Where do you get those guys? How do they, where does their craft come from?
Well, you know, that's a hard question. There's sort of a circle of writers in Los Angeles, people that have been around for years. I have one of the oldest writing staffs in Hollywood, actually. These guys go back to many, many shows you can think of. You know, I have people that go back to Roseanne, the Ellen Show. My current showrunner ran the Reba McEntire show, Reba, for Fox. So they're like it's just like a circuit. And then each writing staff usually incorporates one or two newer, younger kids that they bring up along the seasons. And then those become the new younger writers. But it's a big wheel that goes around. Like writers that I work with on the show or writers that I may have worked with on other shows in the past. There's no real, like everything else in entertainment, there's no front door. There's lots of windows and people climb in the windows.
Let me get philosophical a little bit here about writing and things like that. Most of us think we experience a lot of life. Most of us experience a lot of television. And what we think we've learned about life came from television and watching shows like yours and shows like, you know, the dramas, the police procedurals, the sci-fis, which came out of the mind of writers. Do those guys know real life? Or, I mean, they're responsible for our perception of the world. How do they get that? Am I right?
It is an interesting way to look at it, because I don't want to get too technical about it, but you're not totally off. There is, I'll give you an example. The people that created, let's use The Simpsons, which has been on for like, 1,000 years now. So the people that created The Simpsons probably grew up experiencing theater and literature, which is not to say that the people that write it now haven't experienced those things, but the people that write it now have grown up watching The Simpsons. So it sort of folds back in on itself. So what you're saying, I think, is not inaccurate in that writers certainly have experienced whatever their lives have allowed them to experience. But they're also writing a formulaic thing. You know, a sitcom is a formula, and it has to pretty much stay in that formula. Like, usually there's here we meet the family, there's some particular problem that week, and the family has to try to solve that problem. In the process of trying to solve that problem, they make things worse. And then eventually they have to recover from whatever damage they've did to their family, and usually ends with equilibrium. In other words, you can't really learn anything in a sitcom, because next week we have to come back and do the same thing again. So it's not like, if you solve the problem, the overall problem, then basically the show's over. Now you've got a movie, not a sitcom.
Your show has, and a lot of shows have, a little bit of a story arc. Mm-hmm. Things progress. I mean, there's a child, and he's born, and he's growing up, and people move through their jobs, but it's far slower than real life, except for accommodating, I guess, a growing child. You got to kind of stay with his age.
You do. In the 50s, you could give them drugs to keep them young, but you can't do that anymore.
Really? Wow. You
know, that's producing.
Yeah. So you have a little bit of a story arc, but your main arc is within each program.
Yeah. I mean, there's no way, as you suggest, there's no way to avoid overall relationships develop. And children grow up, or people age. So you have to deal with that as an overall multi-seasonal storyline. But in each individual episode, of course, it has to have a story arc to why are we here? What are we doing in this particular week? What's happening to who? How do we solve it? You know, what have we done? That kind of thing.
Do you talk about acts, first act, second act, third act, yeah, as you're preparing the program? And because I never quite get my mind wrapped around. For as long as I've worked in the business, and mostly I've done commercials, which don't have a story arc and don't have acts. It's 30 seconds long. So people will say, yeah, so in the first act, then the second act, and I go, I can't tell which act I'm watching. I could never tell.
We do. It has to be structured. And, you know, the reason, of course, is commercials, right? That's the act structure is dramatic, certainly. But it also has a lot to do with how one squeezes in the commercial time to make networks like ABC want to buy our show. So we have a four-act structure. We have what's called a cold open, which is the first thing you see, which usually establishes the theme of whatever that week's show is. And then the main title sequence, and then act one, which is sort of the here's the problem and here's how we're going to solve it. And then at the end of act one, here's why that didn't work. And then act two comes back and sort of solves the problem. And then what's the fourth act, which is really called the tag, which sort of sums everything up that happened this week.
Yeah. And that's where, Tim Allen's conservative nature gets mellowed a bit by reality. And
that's where the heartstrings get pulled
every week.
And then usually there's, and also of course, which is specific to our show, is we have the vlog, which, isn't in all shows, but is in most shows, where Tim actually talks directly to the camera
and gets most conservative, except he's tempered.
Yeah. That's his piece where he gets to say, you know, what the character Mike Baxter is really thinking, you know,
yeah,
here's how you should behave in your life to live your life better. And then, ultimately that may be true, and it may be resolved later in the show where maybe that's not the best way to do it.
You know? When you guys began 6 years ago, the idea of doing that was fairly new as social media kind of thing. How did mm-hmm. that get incorporated?
I think that was Tim really wanted to do that. And, he really enjoyed his experience on Home Improvement. And Home Improvement was similar to our show in that he had a family. Obviously, he had sons, not daughters. and he had a workplace. And he also had a third element, which was his TV show. And I think we wanted to find something that was similar to that. And so naturally our show, we've got a family and he's got daughters and he's got a workplace, which is the fictitious outdoor man store. And he has the third element, which is the vlog, which I think takes place of the little TV show that they used to do on, what was the show?
Home Improvement.
No, I'm kidding. Yeah. Everybody wanted to call, you know, when we came back, there were so many comparisons made to Home Improvement, but, we're a different show and we're different characters and, we're becoming as successful as Home Improvement, which is great to see because that show was extremely successful.
Yeah. So as the producer, how much creative input do you have in the, I'm going to say you have a lot of creative input in getting the show through the process of producing and getting on the air. But as each episode is being created, starting in the writer's room, do you get involved in that at all?
Not that much, no, because the writers, television is run by writers, just like movies, feature films are run by directors. Very, very different concept. So writers really will write storylines and oftentimes let me know what those are to make sure they're accomplishable. But it's really their deal. They have to write the show. And in all but a very unusual circumstance would I try to be involved in creatively what the writers are trying to do. I think it's my job as a producer to be able to get their words on the screen via the actors' mouths.
Yeah. And one of the things I noticed in your bio was that you work very hard to never say no. Always say yes. True. Whatever they want to do, you find a way to get it done.
It's true. And I've done some of the more difficult shows. In fact, I hadn't thought about it, but we had our little Christmas party the other night and some of my former employees from, I think in particular, it was Sports Night. And they reminded me that my reputation is the producer that does the hard shows. And I guess Last Man Standing is a bit of a break because it's really not a hard show to produce. But Arrested Development for me was a hard show and Sports Night was a hard show. There have been a few. But I think that's the value you can bring as a producer is to take scripts that others might read and think were really hard to do in some way and say, you know, we're doing it and here's how we're going to do that.
Aaron Sorkin, a interesting guy to work with?
Absolutely. Yeah. Brilliant guy.
Is he difficult?
He was not difficult for me. I think we connected in a way where he wanted to write really funny stuff that might be difficult for some people to produce and maybe not me. And that we can talk about that, but that may have something to do with Ham Radio.
Yeah.
And that was one of my favorite shows ever to produce. And also the director of Sportsnet was a guy named Tommy Schlamme, who's just an amazing director. And together, Aaron and Tommy, and I have to say, luckily for myself, as the third member of that team, we were able to put some really amazing television together. It's still, you know, it's available. It's all on Hulu. Won a lot of awards and got a lot of critical acclaim. Ultimately, like everything else, went off the air.
Yeah, it's on, it's either Amazon or Netflix. It's on one of those two as well. I've seen some of that. Went back and looked. I've been a big West Wing fan, which, you know, was not in my police procedural or sci-fi genre. So I really liked West Wing and I really liked The Newsroom, but then, you know, that's another inside baseball show, but I really liked how they did that. And I was disappointed that it didn't make it through a few more seasons.
Yeah. And I'm sure why, you know, it's the underlying reason is always ratings, but one can't know why people watch one thing versus another.
Yeah. So there was some nefarious reason for my asking about some of these questions about writers and where you can get in on the deal, which sort of transitions to the ham radio part in Last Man Standing. You like to make a very clear point that it is not a ham radio show. It is not about ham radio. It has some ham radio in the background, and it wasn't your idea.
That's correct, yeah.
How'd that come about? You've told this story many times, so you can make
version. I'll try to give you the short version. I was a ham for, I've been a ham for a long time. So it's always been in my background, and I think it actually did a lot to get me where I am, if you want to say that, in my career. But I hadn't played with ham radio in a long time. I've been in California for 30 years. I've been concentrating on my career, and it's one of the things that sort of fell off to the side, although I never let my license lapse, which, you know, I'm glad I didn't. And, you know, we had that initial meeting with Tim Allen. You meet with your actors and the directors and other producers, and you talk about the show. You know, what will the show be? What will the world of Mike Baxter look like, both at home and at work? And Tim was pretty clear right up front that he wanted Mike Baxter to be a very outdoorsy kind of guy that would go hand in hand with his job at the sporting goods store. And surprisingly did say that he wanted Mike Baxter to be a ham radio operator. And I think that had to do with the character being not just an outdoorsy guy and a conservative guy, but maybe just a touch of a survivalist. That is to say, not a prepper, you know, not a crazy prepper guy, but just, you know, being able to, because he's the last man standing, be able to take care of himself, that he would have his home, would have some alternate power sources and some freeze-dried food, some water, you know, just like we in California have earthquake supplies and other people around the country are ready for hurricanes and things. And Mike Baxter wanted to be ready for that. And I think Tim, as a character, saw Mike Baxter as having ham radio in his life for that purpose. But then what really surprised me, I guess, was that Tim personally was interested in ham radio. In fact, he had been to Ham Radio Outlet here in Burbank as our local HRO and looked through the gear and all that stuff. Unfortunately, he didn't come away with any equipment or any training materials at that time. But it showed at least that he was serious about considering ham radio as maybe, I don't know, I don't want to call it a hobby for him, but at least another thing in his bag of tricks.
So did that happen commensurate with getting this program prepared, or had he had some interest in it totally prior to Last Man Standing?
He had prior interest. He had definitely had prior interest because when we first met, we had just, we were talking about producing the pilot. We hadn't even produced the pilot yet. So this had been in his recent past, I think. You know, he lives more or less in the San Fernando Valley, so he would be familiar with the Burbank area and ham radio outlets. So he would take a look at ham. When you don't know about ham radio and you go to a ham radio outlet, it's a little overwhelming. There's a lot of radios on a shelf and you don't really know what any of them do. And I think he was interested in the concept of communication and personal communication and ham radio, but I don't think he knew much about it or how one would go to the next step. And of course, I knew immediately when he said that I would be able to not just create that story thread for the show, but that if he wanted to pursue it personally, that we would be able to help him do that.
Did he know you were a ham as this idea was being developed and he started talking about it? So that
he did not. Ham radio is not something you generally discuss in your meetings when you're trying to get a producing job. Yeah. Because you know, and your viewers well know what the overall thought about ham radio is.
Crazy guy in the attic.
Yeah. Or the basement, more like the basement.
Yeah.
So it's not something that I would actually, I don't think that words ham and radio ever came out of my mouth in that sequence in a very long time, because it's not something I would discuss, you know, chatting with a vice president of production at a studio who was, you know, thinking about hiring me to produce a show for them.
Now, were there any other hams that you were aware of anywhere in what was coming together as a staff for this program?
You know, there were a couple. There were a couple of hams, and you know, you don't find out about the hams until you start talking about radio, because most people don't wear it on their chest. They're not the average employee in Los Angeles is not walking around with their call letters on a hat. you know. But once we started to put the theme together, then people come out of the woodwork and they'll admit to you, oh yeah, I've got a ham or I've got a license. And let's face it, the part of the crew we didn't talk about, especially the technical people. Well, I've got scads of technical people. I have four cameras on the show and three microphone stations. So I've got like, you know, 50 or 60 people that are all techs. So they're going to, I mean, I don't mean techs because technical. And some of those people had already had ham radio licenses just from their past experience.
Yeah, because that's where we're typically seated within any community, the technical side. Although, there have been some famous on-air people that have had ham licenses as well. You know, we like to talk about them. But we don't talk very much about the technical side, the engineering side, which attracts a lot of hams, but not as many as you might think. You probably encountered them throughout your career, though.
Yeah. They'll admit to you that they're hams once they know you're, it's like, I don't know. I don't want to use any weird analogies, but if someone
a
knows
cult.
You're a ham,
go ahead.
More
it's
likely
a cult.
Yeah. Well, if they know you're a ham, they're more likely to say to you, "Oh yeah, I've had a ham radio license since I'm a kid or whatever." So a couple of people on the show had already had ham licenses, so that actually helped me because, you know, putting real ham radio anywhere, you know, in your ham shack is not that easy. It has to be worked out and make it work, debug it. And doing it all by myself while I'm trying to produce the show is not that easy. So I've had to have some help doing it.
Yeah. My wife works for a big technical company. Their headquarters up in Silicon Valley. And for a while, their CEO was a ham, a very famous contester. And I'm saying, in a meeting, you know, even if you're one of 30 people in a meeting with that guy, get this little ARRL pin, just, you know, very subtle, stick on your collar and he will notice you. But she never did that. She never did that.
It's the underground secret society, you know.
But that was a tech company, so it wouldn't have been too
weird. Yeah,
But
that's the people that had licenses on my show were entirely technical, you know, video and sound and those kinds of people.
Yeah. So turning that back to writing, in each of the first two seasons, there was a single episode. Well, I wanted to talk about the single episodes that had a very strong ham radio theme, but let's take a step back further to more generally how ham radio got into the background. You were talking about Tim's character, and so somebody somewhere had to decide, well, how is this aspect of his character going to be displayed so the audience can see it?
Yeah, you know, that actually was my doing. And as much as I say, I don't write the shows and I don't have that much direct influence in writing the shows, but what you can do as a producer is you can expose the writers to things. So, and it doesn't matter what it is, you know, like if I had put an outboard motor on a set as a prop, somebody might've written an episode about boating with small outboard motors. So we pretty deliberately built the ham radio station on stage just so that people and in particular the writers would see it. And either start asking questions about what it was and or incorporate it into an episode. And that's kind of what happened, that they saw it. They started to ask questions about it. I did do a little briefing with the writers, which I think was really helpful. And eventually it made its way into a couple of stories.
So it was actually pretty organic.
Yeah.
Because I was going to ask how much lobbying you had to do. I know it would be delicate because there are divisions of labor. They don't want the producer telling them what's going to be in a show.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how.
I have a pretty good relationship with my writers. We're all pulling in the same direction. And they're looking for stories. I think that it's not, you know, people that write a show, when we come into the situation, there's nothing. There's nothing preordained or predetermined or pre-written. So they're looking at the character and the interplay between the characters and the things that those characters do. So it was a fairly natural thing because Tim expressed an interest and because the equipment was there, for the writers to walk by that much radio equipment every day and not wonder what it was or what it did. And so I actually did a thing I went into the writer's room one morning and sat down for a while with the writers. And I, in a very as subtly as I could, explained what ham radio was and that Tim was interested in what one could do with ham radio. Because as you know very well, because I've heard you say it before, and as all hams know, you can shut somebody down by telling them about ham radio.
Yeah.
There's so much you can do with ham radio. And so what I had to choose to tell the writers was extremely small amount, just enough for them to explain. Number one, it's not CB radio. No one will ever be saying breaker breaker on that radio.
Yeah. Well, you're talking about not pointing the fire hose at somebody and trying to explain everything at once, which most of us try to do whenever someone shows a glimmer of interest.
Many do. And then it's the fastest way to turn somebody off to ham radio is to start explaining moon banks and satellites and
ATV,
PSK,
all the weird stuff.
You just can't do it.
So you're sitting with the writers and giving them as gentle an introduction as you can.
Yeah. I think what I mostly wanted them to understand was the basic nature of the hobby, just that it's a hobby where people can communicate and enjoy communicating with one another, and the fun one can have and the knowledge one can gain by learning from how to put that station together. and then a very small amount of how it can be used and is sometimes used in emergency situations. That's really all I talk to them about.
Yeah. And that's, I think, is pretty instructive to all of us, especially PIOs and folks who have to deal with the public and the media, but all of us at one point or another talk to people about it and try that fire hose thing. And so it's pretty instructive to see how you did it. And it, you know, kid gloves, very gentle introduction.
Less is more.
So now in the first season, there was an episode toward the end of the season that had a ham radio, I'll call it a subplot. There's usually an A and a B plot or plot line.
A story, B story.
Almost like I've worked in this business.
Yeah.
Doesn't happen in commercials. One story.
It's no B story in a commercial.
No, not usually. So ham radio got worked into a B story in toward the end of the first season. It was, Mandy getting in trouble, not paying enough attention to school and needing to do some studying, do some research, and suddenly stumbling upon this ham radio station in the basement that nobody'd seen before.
But it was there. It had always been there. You just hadn't seen it yet.
And now everybody in the show has got a ham license. Kyle's got a ham
license.
Only
the ones that I made have ham licenses.
Yep. And she stumbles on this radio and talks to these people.
Who are you people?
Mandy, that's how ham radio works. Right now, there could be hundreds of people all over the world listening to every word you say.
And gets her answers to the whatever report she's got to do for school and aces it, which surprises everybody. Because that's her character. You know, she's not supposed to be a brilliant student. And so ham radio is a hero. And there's a attractive young woman playing with it that says,
so basically it's exactly like Twitter, but more advanced because you don't even have to type.
Did you write that line?
I did not, but I did have a lot of discussions with the writer of that episode. Okay. You know, I mean,
what was the dance to get that sub, that B plot in there?
I have to say, and that was written by Michael Shipley, and he did a great job because we had gone back and forth about ham radio, and I'll tell you why ham radio is so hard to put on primetime network television. So now imagine you've got 18 really smart, really funny guys sitting in a room, and they are just razor sharp wits. And what they know about ham radio is that ham radio are fat old men sitting in their basements, basically talking to each other with Southern accents.
Yeah. Suddenly I'm hearing nightmare scenario for hams.
Yes. So the first couple of pitches were just, first of all, everything that they would have done would have been completely illegal. Mandy creates her own radio station via ham radio and plays her favorite, you know, music cues and things like, you know, those kinds of things. Things like we could never put on the air, or at least I couldn't allow to be put on the air because, you know, the hams would have come to my house with fire axes. And
they almost did anyway.
Yeah, they almost did anyway, because you can't really please anybody. But we'll get to that. And I think that Michael did a great job. He wrote this story that completely interwove ham radio with what would be anybody's completely conventional family story. Daughter's not paying attention. Why? Because she's got her computer, her cell phone, her Twitter, her Facebook. Just like, by the way, we got a lot of very positive comments. Everybody's daughter seems to be doing, right? I mean, overwhelmingly, the comments we got were, that's my daughter, you know, and eventually you've got to take your, maybe some parents have to take their kids' phones away or computers away. And that could have been the story. The story could have been Mandy gets her phones taken away and something else happens.
Yeah. And we've seen we've seen that story on a lot of shows.
Sure.
Of course. It's not original.
And luckily for us being the hams is that Michael Shipley, who wrote it, found a way to say, okay, well, here's the ham radio thing. What can I do with that? Well, maybe Mandy uses the ham radio. So that was sort of the first concept that was like, yeah, that would be great because she could do that. And that would be a good use of the radio. And we could make it so that it all worked out legally for her to do it, which we did ultimately. And so you talk about organic, that worked perfectly. And it got actual radio content. You know, I mean, people talking on radios on primetime network television seen by 7 million people. So that's been done before. I mean, other shows have had ham radio on them, but mostly not accurately and mostly not in any positive way.
Yeah, we'll talk about the accuracy in a little more detail, because I want to hear about that. And I think people either want to hear about it or need to hear about it. Sure. Let me start with the first decision. You did not play any actual single sideband sound. It was just ordinary filtered audio from probably post-production. Why did you ever consider even running something through a sideband radio and making it sound sideband, putting in some interference?
I wouldn't do that because the funny thing about having a primetime network show is you've got to appeal, and you'll hear this phrase many times. You must appeal to the mass audience, and the mass audience does not know what sideband is.
Yeah.
So they're going to get up. They're going to go get up and start thumping the side of their television set.
What's wrong?
To find out what has just gone wrong with their something. Boom, boom. Something's wrong with the speaker, honey.
There's nothing wrong with your television.
Yeah.
Recontrol the horizontal.
It's like if you've ever heard of the process called film look. Remember we had film look where we would take a videotape and we would put grain on the image to try to mimic film grain.
Yeah.
And when we would send that out to the network, they would reject it technically for excessive noise. So it's the same thing where all of our shows go through a very strict technical process where they listen to it and look at every frame of every film. And I think they probably would have come back to me and said, we need to understand clearly what all of your characters are saying at every moment in time. And we find that this process is hurting us in that regard. So we chose to just sort of filter it. We put a little bandpass filter on it rather than make it. I mean, I certainly could have made it single sideband. That would have been very easy, but it would have probably been not so good for the viewers that don't know what that means.
Yeah. Film look is a real super inside baseball thing. And it mm-hmm. Goes back to early days of videotape. And I guess people said it looks too real and film has some other character to it. And so there were desperate attempts to make things shot in video.
Yeah.
Look like video things look like shot on film. And
absolutely.
There is a process now that actually does a pretty good job. And does anybody care? Have you guys considered, you shoot on video?
No, we don't. We shoot it in HD. It's I won't call it tape because it's all digital now and doesn't go to tape anymore, but but we shoot in 24 frames. And again, I don't want to take your viewers on a, that's a whole other podcast somewhere.
We're semi-technical.
Okay. But, the video, as you know it from She's the Sheriff and or whatever else, would be shot in 30 frames per second. And that gives you a very real quality to the motion. And probably better for sports, but not for dramatic or comedy shows. And film is shot in 24 frames per second. So that gives you a little bit more of a softer motion quality. And also film has film grain. And I'm sure, the older viewers that actually know what film means and not the digital, film grain tends to, in a way, average out the picture. The film grain prevents you from seeing the pores and the sweat beads on the person you're looking at, much the same way putting a diffusion or a stocking in front of a camera lens does. And then when we went to digital, now it's just sharp, crystal clear, probably too much for some people. So the people at Sony, for the most part, and Panavision have developed technologies to make the video look less harsh and a little bit more like film. And that's kind of how we're shooting now.
Yeah. There was a brief time when people attempted to transfer video to film. And the little bit of it that I saw, I thought gave me the impression that it looked more like film. It took the video-ishness out of it.
I've done those experiments. They're just very expensive. I mean, I did the first high def television show ever was my show. It was called Titus. And Titus was like a guy who was a car enthusiast and he had a lot of hijinks and races and stunts and explosions. It was a real fun show to produce. And 20th Century Fox was producing it in 35 millimeter film and they were transferring it to PAL because they thought high def was coming eventually, and PAL is 625 lines per second. And as your FastScan TV fans, ham fans will know, NTSC is 525 lines.
So it's a little better.
It's a little better.
And it's not
it wasn't high def at all, really. And it seemed to me like I used to go to CES all the time. I was very up on the video technology. And I knew that Sony had just come out with the first generation of high def cameras, which was the F900. So I called Panavision, who purchased the first wave from Sony, and asked them if they had four cameras in Los Angeles. They did. And I asked them if they would give me all four, and if they would, that I would produce a TV show in them. And they sent a truck over with four version one F900 Sony HD cameras. And we put Titus on the air as a high def show instead of a film show.
Yeah. So I guess we're going through the same thing now with 4K.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, we just got over the 3D thing, which didn't seem to go very far.
Yeah.
And now we're there with 4K. So, I mean, now we've had to learn a lot of techniques to take the curse off of HD. In other words, and seriously, if you have aging actors, actresses, you've got to deal with the parts of their faces that you couldn't see before, fine lines and blemishes, and or you can literally see people's pores. You can see people's hair plugs if they have them. I mean, you know, and you've got to deal with that somehow, either in diffusing the camera and or lighting techniques and or electronically fixing that in post-production. So as you go 4K, it seems to me like probably great for some things and probably not for others.
Yeah. I'm not – Ham Radio Now is probably never going to be 4K, but I did go from standard definition to high def, and then buy all new equipment and the same transition to 4K, but it's coming. I've heard people talk about it in the lines of, you know, people said, I don't see why we got to go to high definition. I like television just the way it is. And well, the difference was night and day. I don't know about, I haven't seen very much 4K. I've seen a little bit in a Best Buy or whatever. And I don't see the night and day, but I see, you know, maybe twilight to early afternoon. It's kind
of, it's a higher resolution format. I guess it just depends on what it is you need to put on that format. I guess if you're shooting in film, which I don't think anybody shoots in film, and transferring to 4K, that would be an amazing, evolution of things, because the film would look great and the 4K would preserve the quality of the film.
Yeah. Film has always been at about 4K resolution or maybe a little better.
Exactly. 35mm
film.
You could keep the resolution. I mean, if you were shooting, if you're shooting 70mm, you'd want to transfer to 4K to not lose some of that resolution. But for our purposes, we're pretty happy with what we've got, and if the network makes the decision to go to 4K, we'll go to 4K. But just as you say, as consumers, we only have to go out and buy a couple of TVs, so it's a few thousand bucks maybe. For a television studio or a network, they've got to go out and spend $1 billion to buy all new equipment. It's really tough.
Did you ever in your life up until the past decade think you were going to spend more than $400 on a TV set?
Oh, maybe not. But what's great right now is, and I just replaced all my TV sets. Now a 42-inch flat screen costs $399.
It's back. So, yeah, it's kind of back down there. But for a little while, I mean, I thought I made a great deal when I bought a 720p plasma for $4,500.
Yeah.
Because
a
year earlier, a friend of mine paid $700 for virtually the same, or $7,000 for virtually the same TV. So yeah, interesting. Do you guys, when you do the show, do you do it switched? Do you live switch between the cameras and then trim up edits afterwards, or is it fully edited afterwards?
It's fully edited afterwards. All the cameras are isolated, as are all the microphones, although the mics are mixed in a quick temp mix so the audience can hear it better. If you were sitting in the audience, you would see the show switched, because there is a guy that sits in a booth and switches it, but that's just for the benefit of that studio audience.
Yeah. So same as the mics. You got to give them the show. A production of sorts.
Yeah. If you show them the quad split, they're not going to know which camera to look at.
Yeah.
So we switch it for them, for their benefit. We don't use that for any other purpose. And there's some union reasons why we don't do that. And then those master tapes get transferred into Avid, which we use the Avid editing system. And then we've got an amazing editor who, within a very short amount of time, makes that into a television show.
Yeah, I was going to ask which one you use. So you use Avid. I use a Premiere Pro here. I grew up on Avid when I first got started with nonlinear editing. And what we're seeing right here is live switched. I'm pushing buttons on this little pad. And there you go, this little pad. So I'll push this button and my face will appear. Mm-hmm. And so this is live switch. But when I do the Tapper conference. I shoot on four separate cameras and roll and record four separate cameras. And then I bring them into Premiere Pro. They line up as four little icons on the screen, and I switch back and forth until we're done. So a very similar process of production. Although I almost would have guessed that you would do it switched and then just trim things that didn't work.
That's an older school. Like, if you think about shows shot in the 80s and maybe even in the 90s, they would be in the booth, so to speak, you know, with the take ready one, take one kind of thing.
Yeah.
But we don't do that anymore. And this, because our shows, multi-camera sitcoms, are more of an outgrowth of the film production. So the cameras are on the floor, the director's on the floor, the writers are on the floor. There's no booth per se. We just all have director's chairs around monitors. And so that we switch it really for the benefit of the audience, not for the benefit of the home viewer, because it's, you know, the ultimate product is not going to be, I think, in the, let's say, Norman Lear days, All in the Family, where they actually switched it live and recorded the live switch. And they would only go back and change maybe to a different camera angle, or once in a great while to a different take. So it was almost like watching a live show get recorded. But with us, we really want the benefit of looking at each individual take, and almost on a, not a word by word, but a line by line basis. And what you see at the end of the, when the show airs, is just the absolute best of each individual line.
I want to ask a question to reveal some secrets of the actors. How well do they know the script when they walk in?
Very well. They're expected to be able to say the script more or less verbatim.
Okay, so it's not almost, you say you edit line by line based on what you're on their performance.
Right.
But their performance has to come as mostly a smooth flow. Because when we see outtakes, see bloopers and things, it's always actors blowing lines.
Yeah, usually.
Everybody enjoys blooper reels except me and maybe other editors, because all that meant was I had to work harder.
Yeah, you had to make a blooper reel, that means, yeah.
Well, that and cover up the blooper for the real final production. So, yeah, they're cute for a while.
Yeah.
But
they're fun.
Yeah. But that doesn't, in real production, the folks doing the real work, it's like, oh, can you get it right this time?
Yeah. Now, that's not to say that the actors won't occasionally, you know, try something. And naturally, especially Tim, for the most part, the rest of the cast will try to stay on page, on the script. And Tim may throw an alternate line because he's a comedian, so he's funny. But for the most part, and because the scripts are almost mathematical, if you think about it, what you're doing is you need, let's say, a sequence of four lines, and the fourth line is going to trigger a laugh. If you change line two or three of that sequence, you're not going to be able to get to line four, which is the place the laugh comes. So you can't change too much, you know, or you can change something to get a big laugh, but that laugh may not get on air because it's not what was intended to happen.
Yeah. There was an interview I saw with, I think it was Bradley Whitford, one of the guys in All the President's Men. Aaron Sorkin is famous for those long single camera shots tracking through hallways.
And
yeah. And Bradley said, that what he liked to do was, when he was doing one of those with a guest actor, is blow his line early in one of the first takes to take the pressure off the guest actor who is not used to doing those show after show after show. Yeah. So a very kind thing to do. And he did it evidently on purpose, or maybe he always screwed up early.
Those were challenging. We did in a lot of that in Sports Night.
Aaron Sorkin.
In fact, yeah, Aaron Sorkin. And I kind of designed that set to be a television studio. I mean, here the ham radio background is this. It's that I was met with the people at Imagine Television about, actually not about Sports Night, just about to meet them generically. And they were telling me about this show they had called Sports Night, set inside a TV studio. And they said, yeah, how would you do that as a producer? And there happened to be a whiteboard in the room. So I got up and I started drawing a television studio and all the interconnects and where the monitors would be and how you would, you know, get, how you would make it look like a real working television studio. And on the way home, my agent called me and said they would like you to produce Sports Night. So, you know, and
I had you didn't know it was an audition, but
It wasn't supposed to be. You know, that's nothing's more stressful than thinking you can now go home and sit in your backyard and getting hired to do something. But we designed those hallways knowing Tommy, the director, likes those camera styles, and Aaron likes to write those long dialogues. So we would do Steadicam shots that would start at the actual entrance to the stage. I mean, you know, not the fake entrance, the real entrance to the stage. And they would just go through our hallways, through the hallways of the studio we were shooting in, because you needed so much real estate. You know, if you want to do a 5-minute shot, you need a lot of real estate. So that is definitely a signature of both Aaron and Tommy, and boy, they did it well. And it was always fun to see a Steadicam shot complete successfully, you know, because as you say, the minute someone says one wrong thing, that's it. You got to go back to the top and start all over again.
Yeah. You don't want to see someone blow their line in the last 4 seconds of that shot.
Oh, nothing's worse than that.
But it happens. It happens.
It does. Yeah.
So getting back to Ham Radio Reality, the writers and producing that first episode that had ham radio stuff in it, you got some heat for things that weren't exactly the way ham radio might be. Mm-hmm. And I think hams would benefit from understanding that there's the necessity of doing, as you've explained, a show that is going to appeal to the whole audience. So when you're looking at reality of ham radio versus something that's going to flow into a show, how do you make those decisions? And let me preface that a little bit by saying, if you do a cop show, nobody mm-hmm. flinches at the sound of a gun. Guns are loud. Anybody who shoots guns know guns are allowed to use hearing protection. These guys are shooting bang, bang, bang all over the place. Nobody flinches. Nobody. Because there's no loud sound there. Doctors, lawyers, police, these programs are filled with people doing things that happen in reality all the time. Nothing like what you see on television. Mm-hmm. That's just the way it has to be. If they did reality, no one would watch.
Yeah, I think, I mean, first of all, yeah, if anyone that's fired a gun, I'm sure, and the ham radio audience is also known for, some amount of gun ownership. You pick up a gun, hold it next to your ear and fire it, you've just lost the hearing in that ear probably. So yeah, and if you're a doctor and you just like throw someone down at a table and give them a tracheotomy with a ballpoint pen, that may or may not be successful. So, but you have to take some dramatic license. And I think in that particular episode, which would have been what episode? I don't remember. 2-something was the fight. Maybe it was 3-17. Don't remember. I wish I did. I can look it up. But we had Mandy wander down into the basement where Tim's or Mike Baxter's, really his main shack is in his basement at the house. We just had never been in that set at that point in the season. I already had the equipment, so I could have set it up anytime I wanted it. And she's looking actually for a computer. She thinks she's looking for a computer, and she stumbles across an old typewriter and wonders where the monitor is and, you know, those kinds of jokes. And then hears the voice of her boyfriend, Kyle, coming out of her dad's radio, and then goes over to the radio and starts a conversation with Kyle. And Kyle's in the process of having a conversation with Ed, who happens to be down in the Amazon. And she engages in a conversation with the two of those guys and then ultimately meets other ham radio operators on the air. So the heat part of that from the ham radio operators was, well, Mandy didn't ID. So in other words, she didn't pick up the mic and call Kyle using his call sign and using her call sign. And then she had a short conversation with him. And to which I have to explain to the hams, who all actually know this, that at no time are you required to give your call sign at the beginning of a conversation. You only have to give your call sign 10 minutes in and when you sign off. The conversation only went about 2 or 3 minutes, and we never saw them sign off on the air. So technically, no rules were broken. But, you know, the hams are not going to take that kind of an explanation. they were pointing out to me how we violated, exactly which FCC rules we violated, and how we set ham radio back 100 years by showing either a pirate radio operator or, you know, at worst, I guess, or just a CB radio style operation portrayed as ham radio.
Yeah. So what they want you to do is produce a chapter of the license manual.
Yeah,
and make that part of the show. Yeah, there's a little sophistry in saying, well, you know, she didn't really talk long enough to have to ID, because clearly she didn't know what ham radio was.
But she is licensed, as you well know.
KF0XIE. Yeah. Now, Tim's call sign on the show, Mike Baxter's call sign, is actually not in the ham radio service.
That's right.
KA0XTT.
Right. That's an experimental call sign.
Yeah. And KF0XIE would be a real ham radio call.
Yeah, it would.
Does it belong to somebody? Did you check that out?
No, at the time it did not. I don't, you know, so I
probably often wonder somebody has gone for that now.
I wouldn't doubt that somebody's grabbed it by now. But, you know, it's kind of like using, I'm not going to say a telephone number, that's a different thing. But if you create a fictitious product and it is currently not trademarked by anyone, you can put it on the air. Once it becomes a real, actual trademark product, you can't use it anymore. But if you got to it first, you can do it. So we put, you know, KF0XIE at the time was totally clear. So we used it. And at this point, it might be used by someone. But I think we've already established it as you know, and I have the KF0XIE QRZ page. Like, I administer it. And no one has come to me and asked me to relinquish it because they've gotten the real call.
All right. So I guess the bottom line here is, you hams, you can't put a chapter of the license manual on. I couldn't do it on this show. You can't put it on a network primetime show. But you at least came as close to reality of ham radio as an entertainment program designed to appeal to 8 million people could do.
Yeah, and I think that we made it as accurate as we could. And more importantly, we showed a couple of young people, which I think is really the emphasis here, effectively using ham radio for communication. You know, Kyle is sitting at Mike Baxter's radio in Outdoor Man talking to Ed, who's sitting in the Amazon, and Mandy's in some other part of Colorado talking to Kyle. So at the very least, you know, some number of million people saw people talking on ham radios as an effective form of communication. And for, I have to say, 90% accuracy rate, probably, the home viewer wouldn't know the ID issue, and only the hams would. And overwhelmingly, the hams were positive about seeing ham radio and seeing especially Mandy, yeah, a young, attractive girl, enjoying ham radio, right? And yep. Just a few people, you know, said to me that I had violated the rules and that, well, first of all, there were some people that thought I actually violated the rules, that we were actually transmitting, which, of course, we were not actually transmitting anything. Yeah. We were transmitting it to dummy loads. And
but you can with that station, though.
Yeah. Like, absolutely.
You got antennas up in the air and you get on the air. We'll talk about that in a minute.
Yeah.
So I get over it, guys. The second episode that had a big ham radio segment was one of those Tim talks to the cameras doing his vlog at Thanksgiving the next season. And saying he's thankful for ham radio.
What am I thankful for? I'm thankful for radio, specifically ham radio. So this Thanksgiving, while the rest of you are enjoying your turkey, I'm savoring my ham. Happy Thanksgiving, FCC, because I know you're listening.
How did that one come about?
You know, that's just a gift. That was a gift. The storyline... Again, organically, because the storyline was specifically that Mike Baxter wanted to be left alone at Thanksgiving. And the more he wanted to be left alone, it seemed like the more people wanted to come to the house and participate in the holiday. And he wanted to find a place where he could escape the family and have a few minutes alone and actually listen to a football game in particular. So he chose to go down to the basement where his bomb shelter is and his ham shack is, and get on the radio and at least ask some other hams what was going on with the football game. That's kind of the backstory. What coincided with that is that his grandson, Boyd, at the same time had to do a video interview as a school project. So he wanted to interview his grandfather about what he's thankful for. And when Boyd rolled camera for Mike Baxter to talk about what he was thankful for, Mike Baxter talked about being thankful for ham radio.
Now, the writers, did they come up with that as the subject on their own? Are you walking by the writer's room now and then with a little elbow out going, one more ham radio thing?
Well, you know, I don't do it overtly, although I do kind of try to keep poking them with things that might be interesting for them.
But you have created the environment where the station's there.
Yeah.
The set, the basement set with the ham radio stuff in it, that's not maintained week to week.
No sets really are. I think that's one of the things that surprises people that come to a show. And, you know, we have a lot of guests that come that are hams because they're attracted to the show. When you see our living room, dining room, and usually Mike Baxter's office are sets that are there all the time. But a stage is a really expensive thing to rent. So if a particular episode, the writers write something like, we need to go to Boyd's school, or we need to go to Vanessa's workplace. Those are sets that come in for that particular episode. So we might have to have pull Ed's office out of the way, or pull the master bedroom out of the way and build something there. So sets are changing constantly.
So the walls and stuff, they can be stored fairly easily.
Yeah.
The set pieces, but then they get constructed. How do you do a multi-set program with a live audience? Are you shot linearly? That's hard to do.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, the sets don't come and go within an episode. They go, you know, episodically. So in any episode, you've always got the kitchen, the living room, the dining room. You may or may not have the backyard. You may or may not have the outdoor man store retail space, which is the sales floor. You'll often have Mike Baxter's office and Ed's office. You for a particular episode, then need to bring in what are called swing sets, like Ryan and Kristen's apartment, or their basement, or the basement, Mike Baxter basement set, or the master bedroom set. Those are things that come and go on a week-to-week basis.
Now, when you're shooting the show, do you shoot linearly from beginning to end, or because a movie would never be done that way?
No, we do it. It's a linear, because the audience has to understand the story.
Yeah.
So although we will usually have pre-shot a number of those scenes out of sequence before the audience arrives, when the audience sees it, they see a play. They're watching basically a very linear stage play that takes place in usually 2 to 2.5 hours. We start shooting promptly at 6 o'clock, and we're almost always done by 8:30.
So you do shoot, you will shoot some of the episodes in advance or afterwards if you need to pick something up and fix it?
Yeah, very little. If for the best example of that would be a stunt or an effect. So for example, if someone's climbing a rock wall and has to fall to the floor, that's a stunt, and you need fall pads and stunt guys. And so you would probably shoot that ahead of time and roll it in as a pre-shot piece.
Okay. So now we all are experts in producing television programs. So that's pretty cool. You have done a lot about ham radio behind the scenes that has nothing to do with the show and nothing to do with creating an audience of 8 million people, but has everything to do with creating interest in ham radio within the ham radio community and within people that might be interested and attracted to it through watching the show. You weren't active as a ham when this program was in its early stages.
No, you know, correct. I was
this,
not.
This kicked your interest in again. And now you've got crew and staff licensed. You've got Tim Allen licensed. Why bother? I mean, people are generally going to think that had something to do with those couple of episodes that had ham radio directly in them, but I'm thinking not so much.
No, because it was kind of fun for me to do it. You know, I've said to people before, a TV show takes a long time to shoot. So we work long hours every day. We have a lot of time, you know, we have a lot of time on our hands. So you need to find amusing things to do. And ham radio amused me as a kid. And I still find it very interesting. And when I plugged back into it, I was really pleasantly surprised to find the level of technology and how things had changed. So it kind of brought me back into the hobby personally. But also, part of this is, this is not altruistic. I really thought that, all right, there's 750 or 60, whatever, thousand hams. Those are demographically older, middle to upper middle class, mostly men, I think. Some of those people would be Tim Allen fans or could be made to be Tim Allen fans. So first of all, selfishly, why not tap into that market, right? Why not use the ham radio as a little bit of a lure to maybe bring some number. And I will never know how many people have stumbled onto the show because of ham radio. I don't think very many, but some, right? I would take an extra 10,000 viewers.
Okay.
If I could get them.
Right? Yeah. I was going to say if half of the licensed hams, you know, 500,000 added to the show, maybe in the first season, that would be a important percentage of the audience. Today, now you're doing this for the love of ham radio, to steal a phrase from ICOM.
Totally. It's fun to do. I started when I put the radios on initially and started to think that maybe we could use ham radio as a promotional thing, which clearly we've done to whatever effect it's had. It doesn't matter, but we've done it. I didn't want it to have people think, was a shameless promotion. It's like we put a ham radio on in the background and no one will ever touch it. It'll just basically be a prop. And no one on the show will ever get a ham radio license or ever progress in their ham radio interest. So it made a lot of sense to encourage some of the crew to get licenses. And also, again, they have a lot of time. I have a lot of young people that, you know, production assistants and secretarial type people and production coordinators that for the most part, are in their cubicles downloading music illegally and texting each other. So I floated the idea at that point that there could be some incentives to people that wanted to get their ham radio license. The first of which being they'd learn something, but also they'd get a free radio out of the deal and, you know, that kind of thing. And surprisingly, a lot of people took us up on it. We started studying right out of the question pool. And so you go, well, that's kind of that cheat where you just sort of memorize the question pool. But not so much, because within a very short amount of time, you could hear discussions among themselves, you know, sort of figuring out, like, what does this mean? You know, what does frequency have to do with wavelength? You know, that's an actual conversation I heard outside my office. I'm like, wow, that's shocking.
Yeah,
I love that, you know,
when it happens, when you've been planting the seeds and the seeds start to grow and then suddenly they're really sprouting and people that you have mentored into from ground zero are talking about something real. And they may not quite understand it yet, but they're...
Well, they didn't understand any of it because, you know, young kids today who all have cell phones and all are very well versed in computer technology. In the first time I sat with the first wave of hams and I held up, I said, you know, you all use this radio every day. And they said, what are you talking about? And I held up a cell phone and they went, what are you talking? I said, a cell phone is a radio, you know, it's like, and I gave them the very, very brief idea of what a repeater was and made them sort of understand how repeater technology was similar to what a cell phone does. And they were just mystified, you know. But within a fairly short amount of time, they started to understand what that meant. And of course, we do use radios on the show all the time because we all have our production office is not where the stage is. And we have a editorial building, writer's building, stage, production bungalow, art department. And we all stay in touch with radio, with, you know, a UHF business band or whatever they call that now, land mobile radio. So it's not like they were completely unfamiliar with radio, but... people took us up. People got our license. We've done three waves, maybe four of licensing, four if you include Tim. And, you know, we built 30 or so hams, not all technicians. We've got a number of extras now. So I think that worked out well. And yeah, I mean, personally, it just amused me to do it. You know, it was fun for me to do it.
I would imagine some of these folks actually took steps into ham radio and are active and get on the air. Some folks got their license and, yeah. Okay, that was cool, but I've got other things to do.
Oh, yeah, no question. I mean, the majority would probably bring it home, put it on their shelf, and maybe never look at it again. Or in one case, because we'll have a power blackout, and, you know, someone went, oh, ham radio, and pulled it up, and, of course, battery's dead, you know.
Yeah, a little too late.
Not just there waiting for you.
Tim wasn't in the first wave of staff to get licensed, but... again, was this his idea?
Yeah, I mean, he had wanted to get licensed initially. I don't think he knew much about the licensing process. And that was one of the things that we could do to help him understand, you know, how that actually worked. I think, you know, even he may have been under the misconception at that time that he still needed to learn Morse code.
Yeah.
So that was the first thing to dispel. It's like, no, you're not going to have to learn Morse code to get a technician license. And he really does love technology and stuff. So I think that's part of a lure for anyone that loves technology is just seeing the equipment. I'm shocked that he had a visit to a ham radio store and didn't buy anything, you know?
Yeah. And that was in his personal preparation for the show.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think it was not for the show. I think it was just something he was interested in. Well, long before the show was even pitched to him, I think he just thought ham radio would be something fun to know about.
Learn about this.
And he went all by him. He's got one of his guys that he went with that does a lot of technological stuff for him. And they went and looked at the gear and walked to the store and managed to get out of there. Personally, I sold ham radio when I was in college. He would have never left if I were there without a radio. I would have sold him something.
Does he have to wear a disguise out in public when he does things like that?
He doesn't wear a disguise or anything like that, but I know it's hard. You know, celebrity is hard.
Yeah.
You know, I couldn't deal with it. I don't know. I don't know how you do. I'm sure you can't walk out around in public with
massive viewership. The only place this happens is at ham fests. And and I will walk through a ham fest. I'm easy to recognize because I've got a camera on a tripod over my shoulder. But yeah, people will, mostly it's, Gary, I love the show. But a few people want to talk, and I am headed to a forum or something that I've never got enough time for. So I try to, you know, thank you very much. I really got to move. But yeah, I haven't had to suffer slings and arrows of celebrity too much.
The time constraints are crushing. I mean, for celebrities like Tim or in Tim's ilk, everybody wants something from you.
Yeah,
clearly. And,
what hams want, and they want me to ask you, and I know what your answer is going to be, but I need to give you the opportunity to give it, is how do I score a contact with Tim Allen?
Well, that would be really random. I mean, because it's not like he's got a set schedule where he's on a particular frequency at a particular time. It would be more likely that we were on the air on the show during our dinner time operation, which I'm sure we haven't exactly said, but that's something we do. And that Tim might be wandering by and choose to sit down at the desk for a few minutes. That would probably be the way it would happen.
So does that happen? Does he come by?
That could happen.
Okay. So let's talk about that a little bit. You shoot on Tuesdays, and every Tuesday you have a little ham radio segment, not segment of the show, but time to play with the radio. How does that?
Yeah, just about.
How does that fit in the schedule?
Every Tuesday we shoot in a pattern usually of 3 episodes on and then 1 episode or 1 week, one where we're not shooting, and that's a hiatus week, and that's a week where the writers can recover and the actors can have a rest.
Yeah. We're in one of those weeks now, right?
We're in two or three of those weeks now because of the holidays.
Yeah. Only reason I can actually get you to talk for this long on the show, which is awesome.
I've shut all the phones off and all that unplugged thing. So,
okay. Shooting week on Tuesday.
When we shoot, and we'll be on a Tuesday night, we usually start on a Tuesday at 10 a.m. and we go till 4 would be our normal dinner break, 4 to 6 basically. And at 6 o'clock, the curtain goes up. So there's a lot of stuff that happens during that. But for the most part, the crew is off from somewhere around 3-ish. We finish shooting the pre-shooting stuff and finish rehearsing. And we're not going to go back on camera until about 6. So we've got a couple of hour window of opportunity. And it occurred to me that that would be a good time to use the radios. Also, I had some of the hams on the show sort of wanting to play with the radios, which I gave the hams have carte blanche. If one of my somebody who's a general class or above wants to get on HF, they're more than welcome to go do it. And we've got at least a couple that really like to play with the radios.
Yeah. Now, again, the station that's in Tim's office set, fully operational, you have antennas up on the roof.
Correct.
You don't have a 200-foot tower, but
no, but I've got a 70-foot high studio, so that's
not bad. Yeah.
Right. I've got because ICOM, as they say, has been very good to us, and there's a 7600 and a 5100 in there, and we mostly use the 7700, the IC 7700, and it's a 200-watt radio. It's got a 40-meter. Dipole set up as an inverted V and a 20 meter dipole and as an inverted V on the roof. The roof is 60 or 70 feet high. The SWR is perfectly tuned because I did it myself. And we get on the air at, 4:30, 4 o'clock Pacific time. People always slam me for not using universal coordinated time. Once even said Zulu, and I got negative comments about using Zulu rather than UTC. But that's hams for you. And we will operate for at least an hour. And we usually make in the order of 100 contacts. We operate as long as we can, but while we're on the air, our audience is loading in. So, you know, 200 people are filtering into the studio. At some point, the DJ starts playing music, and at some point, the warm-up guy starts telling jokes. So it's not always the easiest place to operate. It's like field day inside a comedy club, you know? It gets distracting. But it gets us on the air almost every week, and it gets fans that would like to be able to talk to the stage and to employees of the show and or to that equipment on the set an opportunity to really do it. And, you know, what's cool about it is you're talking to either one of our employees or a guest operator on the actual Mike Baxter radios, and then within 15 minutes, the actors are standing in that set shooting the show.
And the guest operators, what's the deal? How easy is it or how possible is it for someone who's going to be taking an LA vacation to make arrangements to come by and be in the audience? I imagine it's not that easy to get in the audience, period, for a very popular show like that.
No, well, the audience is easy, actually, because we need those 200 people every week. So there is, I'll tell you, I don't have a lower third composed, but www.tvtickets.com, and tvtickets.com will take you to sort of the central staging place for all television shows in Los Angeles. So if you're coming to LA, you want to go on tvtickets.com, see what's available to you for that date, and you can book show tickets. They're free, and you know, unless they're sold out, so to speak, you can come to any show in Los Angeles, and we're there too. Now, hams, of course, have a little bit more of an in because I'm sort of reachable. You know, I have a QRZ page, and if people send me an email saying, you know, I'm Ham and I'm coming to see your show and I'd love to, you know, maybe get a little bit more consideration than the average audience member, I have oftentimes, when there's time to do it, brought a Ham fan down on the stage, let them take a picture with the gear. As far as being a guest operator, there's a number of people that I have to trust. Obviously, when I put somebody on our radio equipment, there's a certain level of trust. I have to know that they're going to be a competent operator. They're also representing the show, so they can't say anything crazy. There's a lot of things you can't do. As you can imagine, when you're actually on ham radio, well, we can say anything we want. We're on Facebook or on your podcast right now. But when you get on ham radio from the set of Last Man Standing, you can't tell hams tune into Last Man Standing at 8 o'clock on Friday night. Because technically that's illegal. So I have to trust the guest operator. So I have a group of people that I trust to do it. And a few times I've let people come in that have been less known to me, which may not have worked out as well as I'd liked. So I have to sort of vet them, if you can imagine what that means.
Okay, so people in the audience here, you're not real likely to end up as a guest operator, but you can sit by the station, get your picture taken.
Sure.
Probably not with the cast. They're all busy getting prepared.
Yeah, almost certainly not. At that time of night, the cast, when we come out of dinner as a crew, the cast goes back into hair and makeup for their final hair and makeup. And then they do, in the hair and makeup trailer, they do what's called a speed read, which they read through the entire script very quickly. You know, the last time through. And then while they're finishing up their speed read, we're ready with curtains. Like, let's, you know, they're running onto the stage and being introduced by the warm-up comedian.
Yeah.
So they're kind of busy. And also imagine they've just memorized a 55-page script. So I can't really put them. It's not like I can put Tim Allen on the air to work a 10,000-person pileup.
Yeah.
15 minutes.
And you'd have that if people got, you get spotted and, yeah.
I mean, we get massive pileups now, even when, you know, a completely unknown operator goes on.
Yep.
And the idea is KA6LMS, they're going to get a pileup.
Yeah. Now, you've had some ham radio celebrity type.
Yes.
Guest I've operators.
And that's really the best possible thing for me is when I can have someone who's known to the ham radio community as a guest operator.
And you, I've seen you put on the Ham Radio Now Facebook page and a bunch of other Facebook groups and pages. When there's going to be an operation, you get on a couple hours in advance and announce it. So you can find out.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And I know the one we've had most recently that got the biggest bang for the buck was Hope Lee, who's the youngest extra in the country. She's a 10-year-old extra class operator. And she came to the show about 2 weeks ago, got on the air and worked for a long time, actually, probably about 2 hours. We had broken for lunch very early, and she had really a lot of fun. And she made a lot of contacts, and I think made a lot of people happy. It was a really good evening for the ham radio aspect of the show.
Yeah, she eclipsed Katie Allen, I think you were saying.
She did. Katie had come out to the show with Dwayne and with Chip Margelli and Janet Margelli, and all in their own rights, ham radio celebrities. And of course, you know, Katie's a girl and a known commodity to ham radio. And the added benefit of the radio station created a very nice pileup. But Hope, I think, a couple of things happened. One is there was more advance warning that people knew that Hope was going to come. So there were people that were waiting to talk to her. And once she got on the air, it was a pretty massive, there's video of it out there. If you want to include a short piece of it, you're welcome to do that.
Yeah. You sent me a link to it, and I don't have it easy in hand, but if you can point me to someplace I can try to dial it up.
Well, it's on, if you can go to our Facebook page, the KA0XTT Mike Baxter Facebook page, that makes sense to you. And then you wouldn't have to scroll very far to find that. It only happened a while ago. I've had some very fun things for me personally. I mean, look, this is about me having fun. Go to the posts area. So to the left, there's a thing that says posts. There you go. And then you're going to scroll past a couple of various, promotional things for the show, because clearly that's what this is supposed to be. I'm co-opting it to make it about ham radio. And then you're going to see Rob's log. Rob is AA6RA, and he's a very trusted operator. And Rob was one of the VEs that tested Tim Allen.
Okay.
So keep going down, and then you're going to get to just scroll rapidly down there, and you're going to see Hope's actual operation.
Okay, let's dial that up for a second here.
Go ahead.
KA6LMS.
You are sounding great here in Missouri. Just wanted to let you know. Go ahead and start calling your preamble, and I'll monitor. And then I have some people who'd like to check in with you as well. Over.
Okay, so they were running that as like a net.
Yeah, almost. Now that's Emmett, who runs Radio Waves, antenna company that she's talking to now.
Okay. Yeah.
And then funny, she went right into her family. She's her sister's probably an even more famous ham radio operator, Faith Hanna, and they just ran right through the whole family and then started taking like general check-ins, if you want to call it that.
Dial into it a little bit.
Yeah.
There's a strong signal.
Yeah.
So she's got the technique down.
She's terrific. She worked a pileup certainly better than I could have. And she took no nonsense. You know, she really ran the pileup like a pro. And as I said, she made well over 100 contacts. And I think she had a lot of fun. And it was great for the hams that wanted to contact her, because a lot of them got in. You know, a lot of people got in our log. And then the people that I don't know if you have an image of, does this work for you if I do?
Oh, yeah. That shows up well.
Okay. Well, when people write into us, they get the KA6LMS QSL card, and they have to send a self-addressed stamped envelope. But as long as they do that, they get an acknowledgement of their operation with us, and it's become a pretty sought-after card. You know, we've only produced we produced 3 cards. Of course, the first and maybe the most important one was the original Tim Allen as Mike Baxter, yep. KA0XDT, which has become sort of a we've given maybe 6,000 of those away. And then a little bit more rare would be the KF0XIE Foxy. And
was that a promo picture taken during that episode?
No, I took that off of tape, if you want to put it that way.
Okay.
So obviously we're shooting 1920 by 1080, which is pretty high resolution. So you can grab almost any frame off the camera and you've got a super high resolution photo. So I just grabbed that frame.
So she was just kicking back as yeah. That was a shot that came right out of the show.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool.
An actual shot. If you watch that segment, you'll see that moment in time.
K6LMS is the club call sign. You guys formed a club. Yep. But you have to walk a fine line between promoting the show on the air.
Yeah.
As employees, you can't do that. A guest operator, a guest operator probably could, except if they're using the club call sign, then they probably shouldn't.
Right.
I mean, I can certainly go on as KN4AQ and say, I love Last Man Standing. You should watch on Friday at 8 o'clock Eastern.
You can say that.
Yeah. But, and you probably never can on the air.
No, I don't operate that often on the air because of exactly, I don't want to be accused of anything like that. The very first thing we did on the air at the show was actually, a special event station called K6H, like Kilo 6 Hollywood, basically. And I had originally thought, well, we'll make this a Last Man Standing sponsored special radio event. And I got an email, and I'm grateful for it, from a high-ranking official at the American Radio Relay League to tell me that I might want to reconsider doing that because it would be an absolute violation of the FCC rules.
So you restructured it, and a local club took on responsibility. Still, same call sign, same event.
Exactly.
Just somebody else running the show.
We just canceled it and rebranded it, and we ran it as K6H. And it was great. We created maybe six, maybe eight stations side by side, 10, 20, 40 meters, D-Star, analog, IRLP. I mean, we just had as much going as we could at the same time.
So this is one of those things that it doesn't do much for the show, does a lot for ham radio, creates a little interest area, maybe a big interest area where people have fun using ham radio. Because sometimes having fun using ham radio can get a little routine.
Well, you know what? Here's the thing about ham radio is that amateur radio, by definition, doesn't have content, if you take my meaning. You produce content about ham radio, as does other podcasters, but that's not on the air. So you really couldn't do what we're doing right now on the air. That would be a radio show. That'd be illegal. So what's content on ham radio on the air? Well, contests, special event radio stations, the national parks. And I guess what I set out to do a little bit with the K6LMS was to create some amount of ham radio content, a destination, something people could look forward to and get on the air and make a contact that would be meaningful to them, certainly to promote the use of amateur radio. Look, underlying all this, which we haven't talked about, is it's the use or lose it aspect of ham radio. It's a great hobby, and it certainly helped me in my life personally. But, will ham radio be here in this form in 20 years? I don't know. Or will it just be more wireless spectrum for people to send cat pictures around the nation?
Yeah. Well, we know it's not going to be here if there's not a replacement generation. Yeah. No, I'm 67. Yeah. You're 35. but we need that replacement generation, and we're having trouble coming up with those guys.
That's why I like the having hope on the show younger people to come on the show. And the Mandy segment, for whether the hams enjoyed seeing it or not, although I know a lot did, more important for me to have Mandy on the radio talking to Kyle, who is a very attractive young actor that girls like, than it is to have yet another older person talking on ham radio in the exact strict letter of the FCC rules.
Yeah. Although the people they talked to in that scene, they kind of got stereotypical.
Well, they were stereotypical hams.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
LOL. Is that right, Mandy? LOL.
Wow, Mandy, this is really fun. But I was wondering when I could see you in private.
After she finishes her history paper, Kyle.
Guys, I'm seriously never going to finish this paper. I know nothing about World War II.
I know a little bit. I was on the beach in Omaha.
That's great, Walter, but my paper's on the war, not on your Nebraska vacation.
I remember the war like it was yesterday. In fact, a lot better than yesterday. I'm in the early stages of dementia.
I had something to do with some of the voice casting. I would have changed more of it if I could have, but, I'm not the final decider of what the voice casting was. Yeah. And they went a little older.
You were talking about the writers. First of all, that nightmare scenario that they wrote first. So those folks that were on the air that they were listening to, that's some of that stuff that got in. But they didn't pull that out of whole cloth. I'm sure that at some point they listened to Ham's talk because it was a little too spot on.
Yeah, I mean, I tweaked a lot of the dialogue just to make it at least accurate because, you know, you can imagine what the first pass of all that stuff was.
Yep.
Scary. I mean, when the very first week that I had the radios on the set, for the most part, the crew was walking by the radios saying breaker, breaker. And it was hard for me to get them to stop doing that but under threat of death.
little tough love from the producer.
Yeah.
Does the technical crew, the guys who are already hams, the guys that are technical, do they get in on this much? Or is it?
They totally do.
The new folks were not part of the technical crew. They were the rest of the production staff.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So they mix it up.
It's a combination of things.
Yeah. I haven't worked in your end of the business. My end of the business, I worked at a TV station briefly. And there was a pretty rigid wall between technical people and production people and the few on-air people, mostly newscasters and stuff. It was not totally love-hate, but you got your thing and I got my thing and we don't cross. Is that a Hollywood thing as well?
No, certainly not in this show. There's a pretty good blending of, you know, writers come to the stage, actors are always on stage, the tech people come, you know, the tech people aren't there all week, by the way, they're only there, you know, a couple of days a week.
Then they go work on another show probably.
Yeah. They work on other shows. It's like, we don't, you know, it's all money. So it's not like I'm going to pay camera people to come to watch the actors rehearse. They come on the days I need them to shoot. But, this is a crew that's sort of a hybrid of people that I've worked with for many years and some people that Tim has worked with. So everybody knows everybody. It's not like, you know, people come in and do their job and don't know the names of the other crew members. I'm not going to go as far as to say it's a big family. You know, I don't believe that crews are necessarily have to be families, but they all absolutely know each other. They all cooperate together. They help each other. And, there's not a lot of us versus them, especially not on this show, but I don't think in general in comedy, at least. I mean, you know, look, we're making a comedy. We're not running an insurance company.
Yeah. So, we've covered three quarters of what I wanted to get to. And the part I haven't got to is a little bit about your background. I don't know how much time you've got left to spend here.
Yeah. Well, that's more up to you. I have time. And
okay. If you've got some time,
running out of, we need to put new tapes in the machine.
I've got big fat honking hard drives here.
Okay.
I got gigabyte hard drives. You wanted to be a ski instructor.
I actually thought I would wind up in the marketing side probably of the ski industry, believe it or not. And I didn't quite make
it. This is a very young man.
Well, through college, you know, after college, my family did a lot of it. I'm from Long Island originally. We're a very outdoorsy kind of family. And,
Not a lot of skiing on Long Island. But not far
away. For some reason, got the bug, you know, to want to be a skier. And I had certainly plenty of boating, water, and ocean, so I didn't need to do any more of that. And started skiing at 10 and found every way I could possibly do to ski. We'd go naturally. Skiing from Long Island involved a lot of driving. So we'd be upstate New York and in Vermont, and you can actually ski in New Jersey and Pennsylvania and Connecticut. But I built a ski ramp.
For those of us Western, you know, Rockies ski bigots, there is right. No skiing east of the Mississippi.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
I hear you.
They try to tell us you can ski here in North Carolina and in West Virginia. And I go, yeah.
We had those little tiny mountains too, you know, there's actually a ski area on Long Island. I think it only had snow on it once in my lifetime. Yeah.
I learned to ski in Illinois flatland, 300-foot hill. When I'm on ski lifts out in Colorado or Utah, and I talk to people that come from the East, and we commiserate. I've never skied Killington or anything in Vermont or up there, but I understand that they don't have snow. They have ice.
That's right.
So it's a different experience, and people travel.
Well, I have to tell you, coming from, I have skied Killington a lot, and coming from skiing, you know, Hunter Mountain, upstate New York, or Killington, where you're literally, if you haven't sharpened your edges the night before, you're gone because you're going to go off the side of the mountain. going from that to the West Coast, so skiing, well, where we ski mainly would be like Mammoth Mountain, Park City, Deer Valley, which I know you like to ski, Park City, and or Aspen or any of the other Rockies. Also, we ski a lot in, you know, like Whistler Blackcomb and in Canada. We try to extend the season. So, you know, Mammoth Mountain in Northern California skis from mid-October all the way to almost July 4th. So it's a very long season when we get a good snow year. Now, naturally, we're in this massive drought, so we haven't had great snow years.
July 4th doesn't sound right. It doesn't compute, but...
Yeah, well, you can do it. It's the snow has got a haze of dirt and dust over it. And actually still ski on it, believe it or not. And then, you know, we'll start out by skiing in Mammoth to tune ourselves up and then usually drift into the Park City Deer Valley area or go off to Aspen or whatever. And then usually throw some new Colorado ski area or Montana or Idaho or something into the mix to try to go someplace new. And then usually comes right back around and ends up in Mammoth because Mammoth skis so late. And if you want to ski beyond that, you've got to go up into Whistler Blackcomb, which is a sort of glacial. And then you can even ski Timberline in Oregon. I skied Timberline in September once, which was just amazing, you know, like to have the year go that almost all the way around the year. But I did grow up exactly what you're talking about, on solid ice. So coming from the east to the west was not a problem for me.
Yeah, you're probably going, this is easy.
The first day I went skiing in the West Coast, there might have been, you know, 3 or 4 inches of brand new snow and people going, ugh, this is terrible. 3 or 4 inches of nothing. I'm like, are you kidding me? 3 inches of fresh snow. You know, for me, that was like bottomless powder. So we're pretty well trained to ski in bad snow.
Yeah.
And it was great to ski on the West Coast.
A quick story. My wife grew up in North Carolina. She loves skiing. She would ski in North Carolina and then the West Virginia. And she was also afraid of flying. She took her first airplane ride and came home on a bus because she was just terrified. I drove her to Colorado in the first year that I knew her. We packed up stuff in the car and drove to Colorado and took her to probably Keystone. And she married me. And took classes and learned to not pilot, but to fly as a passenger without fear. Now she flies all the time. It's a big part of her job. I drove her to Colorado. That's how badly I wanted this woman to experience Western skiing.
Yeah, I've been there. You have to you have to bring women in your life along with the sport, and it's not always easy. I've had the pleasure of teaching a couple of girls how to ski. And in fact, Breckenridge is one of our favorite ski areas from my girlfriend and I. Deer Valley and Park City are probably the most fun because we just know them so well. I know that mountain really well. Probably Mammoth, obviously, like the back of my hand, but Park City, I know it really well.
So my first the first ski run of every trip, we get 1 week a year, unfortunately. Can't do more than that, is I'm not going to be able to remember the name of it. I love Mel's Alley. I love Keystone. The one at the very far end of all of the ski lifts and run names are disappearing from my aging brain. But that's where we go. We go to Park City and we do it during Sundance.
Oh, that's perfect.
Because nobody's skiing. Everybody's watching movies.
That's right. I've been to Sundance a few times and that's exactly the strategy. You don't go to restaurants. You go to the Albertsons and buy groceries. And then you basically eat in your hotel and ski every day and there's nobody on the mountain.
Yeah. We stay in Provo because you can't get can't get a room in Park City. So we stay in Provo.
Well, you can call me next time.
there's a beautiful back road that goes around a reservoir. It's a gorgeous 45-minute drive. And thread your way through Park City traffic a little bit, the Sundance traffic, and then you're in an empty parking lot at Park City. That's cool.
It is the best time. The best, I mean, you can edit as much out of this as you need, but the best ski story I have is a trip I took to Aspen in just a blinding snow. From Los Angeles, you go to Phoenix, and then you get in a very small plane and fly directly into the Aspen airport. And we flew in what was really a blinding snowstorm. The pilot circled over the Aspen airport several times and said, you know, I don't know, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to try to make it on the ground. And if I can't make it in this run, we're going to have to go back to Phoenix. So he got on the ground and the airport closed with our landing. So both that airport and the Denver, Colorado airport were closed officially for the week. So we spent a week in Aspen with a handful of people, no celebrities, no paparazzis, skied every day in fresh powder and basically had the, you know, ski story of our lives.
Yeah. And you can ski moguls. I can't.
Well, you know, as you know, most people don't. I just had a knee surgery, so I'll probably be skiing less moguls in the future.
Was it successful? Did they? You said yeah, it, wasn't, I mean, it wasn't major.
Mostly meniscus tears, but I do have one little full depth meniscus tear, as they like to put it. So I'm going to have to figure out what to do about that next.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't get enough skiing to advance my capability very much at 1 week a year, but I know what I enjoy and I'm pretty good at that. So we have a good time. But how did you get from wanting to be in the ski industry to being in television? Not typically a direct route.
No, truly. A little bit of it has to do with the ham radio background, because I was working in a ham radio store on Long Island called Harrison Radio, long out of business. But it was one of the only places you could get ham radio on Long Island. And I made a friend who moved to Los Angeles. And when I graduated college, my goal was to move to a ski town. So I was going to come to LA for one summer, hang out with my friend Danny, he was a ham, and I met him at the store. And then go to Colorado, probably, maybe Wyoming, and try to get into the ski industry, and more likely marketing. I did have my advanced first aid and CPR instructor and all that, but I really wasn't going to be a patrolman. And I was qualified to teach skiing, but I didn't really want to teach snow plowing to fat old ladies over. And so very quickly ran out of money in Los Angeles that I had to get a job. Imagine that. And flipped open the LA Times. There was a job offer for an audio video installer. And, you know, with the background that all of us hams have, that's a slam dunk. So I applied for it, got it immediately, and started working for this company that basically installed VCRs, stereos, projection systems. I needed no training to do it.
How old were you when you became a ham?
I think I was... I was not a teenager. I was like in the early young 20s. I had played with a lot of radio, mostly CB and other things. And I was a guitarist, amplifiers and recording equipment, but not directly.
You were Bob Heil.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe not as successful as Bob Heil. But more like I was playing with electronics in general and recording equipment and amplifiers before, and CB. But a good friend's dad had a ham license, and we looked at ham as a much more sophisticated, more interesting thing to play with than CB radio. So we all got our ham licenses back in, but probably early 20s or either very late teens or very early 20s.
Okay. So a fairly common, the mentor experience that somebody.
Totally. Yeah. I mean, I got the ARRL handbook at some point and just read it over and over again until it made sense. Cause initially it was Martian, you know, but I was pretty well versed in just electronics in general, and wasn't that big a stretch to get a technician at the time, a tech plus, which means it was the general exam, but with no code. And then I took the general a couple of months later and got the general, but this was back in the middle, late 70s.
Yeah, actually the tech plus was a technician, which was a no code license. And then adding code to it became a tech plus for a while. All that stuff is ancient history that is hard to remember. And
yeah,
generally big mistakes in the way ham radio was put together. That Morse code thing. Okay, so now you're out in LA and you're installing television sets and audio video systems. We're losing the internet again here.
The band
is closing.
Yeah. Let's go up to 40 meters.
Yeah. Okay, it's coming back. You're out in LA. You are installing television sets, audio video.
Yeah, basically, a small company that worked for whoever wanted us to do stuff for them. But of course, you know, you're in Hollywood, so who are your clients going to be? They're going to be writers, producers, directors, and actors. So I very quickly got an assignment to hook stuff up for Norman Lear's company, a Tandem, at the time. And I started to meet the people that worked for Norman, did some work for him at his house, did some work for his producers, writers, and directors. And the wife of, let me put it this way. All right. So I met the associate producer at the time of One Day at a Time, if you remember the show One Day at a Time, was a lady named Patricia Palmer, who ultimately became a friend, and she was helping to run that show. I did some stuff for her in her office and then in her home, and her husband was running Johnny Carson's show, Carson Productions. So they hired me to work at Carson Productions. initially in a very low level job, just to be like a researcher, which is, you know, like a almost a production assistant. But I had had a very strong technical background, and they were putting a show together called Carson's Comedy Classics, which is tonight a clips, a comedy only clips extracted from the history of the Tonight Show. They needed someone that could put together editing systems to be able to do that. And they didn't have anybody on staff or had any sense of how to do that. But of course I did. So they said, well, then put it together. So I assembled very quickly a couple of edit rooms and became the supervising editor of that show. And
I'm going to say you skipped over a little bit, because back in those days, editing systems were not a PC with Windows Movie Shaker or Apple's iMovie on it. They were complex devices. So you learned something in there.
Yeah, of course, you know, but it's funny how from a ham radio perspective, it's not a daunting task. Like if you put the average person with a technician class license in a room with a television, some cables, and a VCR, they're going to hook it up in a few minutes. Whereas, you know, now in the 70s, you know, a VCR was $2,500 or $3,000, was a 3/4-inch deck, and it was probably quite mystifying to the average person. But from my background, I was able to do that stuff. So we sold an editing system to Norman Lear's company, and I installed it. And that very day, they said, okay, we need to edit something tomorrow, basically Saturday or Sunday. And can you do it? I'm like, you know, it's like your whole life flashes before. I had not been an editor. I'd never edited anything in my life. So, of course, I said yes and went home and read the manual, came back the next day and did an editing session for Norman Lear's company.
Yeah.
You know, it's those kinds of opportunities. You just have to be open to them. But when you have the opportunity, you have to be able to deliver. And having the technological background made me capable of delivering.
How long did you stay starstruck?
Not very long.
They became real people too fast.
Yeah. I mean, my first job was working with Johnny Carson. And I went from watching the monologue during college to within 2 years to working with Johnny Carson. You start to realize that entertainers are just like, you know, they're just like normal people. They have the same problems and needs and desires that we all do. They just make a lot more money.
Yeah, just millions and millions of dollars.
They just make a lot more money. Yeah, exactly.
Proving money can't buy happiness, I guess.
No, I mean, you know, you can look, well, certainly there's lots of examples of that out there. You just watch any of those magazine shows at night and you'll see how miserable they are. But, you know, it's a job, you know, it's like running any other small company. You know, what we do in television is we produce something. You could be producing anything. You could be manufacturing amateur radios or cardboard boxes, or there's a number of steps involved. There's a schedule involved. There's a budget involved. And the entertainers that work on those shows are just another resource. You know, naturally, there's a lot of deference to them, but they're an important part of the show, just like the writers are or the director is or the camera operators are. So it's a question of putting all those elements together to make a show.
Yeah. So I guess because they are the people we see, to us as the audience, as the consumers, they are the industry. But
that's right.
Small part of the industry. They're a very important part.
Of course. Yeah. They're
the writers are, you can't act your way out of bad writing.
You cannot actually, you know,
but you can destroy bad writing with bad acting.
You can totally do that. That's so true. I think the only Bill Cosby is given usually as an example of someone who could take minimal writing and make it hilarious. And there are some actors that can do that, you know, with a facial expression. Johnny Carson could do it, could take a joke that completely bombed and turn it around and get a huge laugh. But for the most part,
the audience is turning on me.
He was brilliant at it.
My Carson is pretty bad though. And I said what I said wrong. I said, you can't take bad writing and save it with good acting, although you're giving me examples of where people did. But you can take good writing and destroy it with bad acting.
You can easily do that, yeah.
So you transitioned from technical to my vocabulary is failing me again. Not a technical job, but a production job.
Yeah. Well, I came, you know, it actually worked out in a very linear way for me, and because I was coming from this sort of technical editing background, and I met some contacts with a company called, no one will know these companies, a company called Reeves. Reeves Entertainment produced things like Kate and Allie and other situation comedies.
Yeah. Their names in the credits at the back end of lots and lots of shows.
Yeah. They did a lot of things. And although they had a very big sort of management infrastructure, they had no one there that knew anything about technology. You know, it's not surprising because, you know, studio executives are there to really facilitate the sale of television shows. They're not really there to actually understand how they're produced, and they generally don't. So at some level, they needed somebody who knew something about how shows were actually produced, and more importantly, post-produced, how editing was accomplished and all that stuff. So there I was, and they asked me if I would be willing to join as a studio executive, mostly to oversee the technology aspect, but to a certain degree, that becomes the financial aspect, the legal and business affairs aspect of television production, all topics that are real boring to, you know, your viewers because they don't know what any of that stuff is. But that's part of production, is always legal and technical and yeah, all that. So I did that for a couple of years, and it wasn't going to be the thing that was going to turn me on for the rest of my life. But there was a show at Reeves in production called Dr. Doctor. And it was a very funny situation comedy starring Matt Frewer. Matt Frewer was Max Headroom, for people that have seen the Max Headroom movie.
Yep.
And I became friends with the guy that created that show, is Norman Steinberg. Norman Steinberg is one of the co-writers of Blazing Saddles and was Mel Brooks's co-writer with that.
Oh, man, there's a movie that couldn't be made today.
Absolutely not. Yeah. One of the most politically incorrect movies ever made.
Yeah.
But
it couldn't be made today for all the wrong reasons, because the point of that movie was to lampoon everything that they did, everything that they made fun of. And yet you couldn't make that movie today. And you can't even put it on the air anyway.
Yeah. It's hard to even put that movie on the air. I imagine that they probably made some edits to that movie to put it on. Yeah. If you were to see it on broadcast television, it'd be heavily edited.
Yeah, just about never could make it. They may have done some of the re-recording of some of the words.
But yeah, maybe. Get a voice artist in.
if you're not familiar with it, really, go find yourself a DVD of Blazing Saddles. Awesome.
Yeah, an uncut DVD of Blazing Saddles.
Yeah,
and then. Dr. Doctor, which was a pretty short-lived series, but it did 6 episodes, and then it was about to be canceled, and its staff dissolved, and it was resurrected, and they needed to restaff it. And I offered my services to come in as an associate producer, which in television, an associate producer runs post-production, and I was able to start essentially my producing career as an associate producer and then work my way up ultimately to producing. Just different kinds of duties as a producer. We didn't really get into what a producers do, but there's so many different kinds.
And that's where I started. What does a producer do?
Yeah, exactly.
But there's so many things that have to get done. I mean, hiring people, arranging schedules, all sounds boring. do you miss the technical aspect? It's still on the edge of your job.
No, because I'm involved in everything. I'm involved creatively as well as technological stuff. And producing at my level runs basically the span of the entire production. So although I don't write the show, I'm certainly involved in shaping how the show is going to get shot. I do all of the stuff that is boring, the scheduling, the budgeting stuff. Although I think budgeting is kind of a fascinating and creative thing to do, because nothing gets done without money.
So yeah, but these shows make so much money. I mean, you're shoveling it into the back room by the bucket load.
Here's a very short, very quick diversion of network television. Right, a TV show costs lots of money, an unnamed amount of money, and the network that airs it, so in our case ABC, gives us a percentage of that money, and in exchange they get to air it a couple of times and they get to put commercials on it. And the studio, which is Fox in this case, has to pay all the rest of the money, right? And so that's deficit. That's just cost. They're not making any money from that. They're just taking that money and they're throwing it in a hole. And they have to do that for at least 100 episodes. So if you can think of a very big number in your head that is the studio's half of that money, and then multiply it times 100, you've got to put that much money into the show before it's ever going to see a single dollar in profit. So when the show goes into syndication, and now it's making a lot of money in syndication, the first thing you have to do is dig yourself out of that hole.
Yeah, I've heard that. They make money in syndication, and which means they got to be on, what, 3 years or so at least.
Yeah. Well, you need the 100 episodes, so you get 22 episodes a year, so you can get your 66 to 88 to whatever.
So you're just crossing the line
Yeah, we just went into syndication really in a big way this year. So we have a few more years to go to get out of
debt. But you get paid every month. So.
Yeah, I get paid by the episode, so I'm okay.
But you don't get lots more money from the syndication deal.
I get there are an elite group of people that get percentages of profit, and I'm not among that elite group.
Yeah. And, you know, we've heard about Hollywood accounting, so, and that's not someplace we're going to go.
Yeah. Profit is hard to come by.
Yep. So that's a quick synopsis of a career from a ski, I'll say ski bum, just to be, you know, to be a clickbait headline about it, to a major Hollywood producer.
Well, middle.
middle major.
Middle Hollywood producer.
I interviewed Dave Bell, W6AQ, a while ago before he died, and asked him where he was in the food chain, because he had produced some primetime stuff, and he said toward the bottom of the Hollywood food chain, and he was very humble about it. Yeah, he's a Hollywood producer. He's produced movies and TV shows and stuff, but none of the mega stuff. You're in the rarefied air. You may not be at the top of the mountain. And what's at the top of the mountain these days? Big Bang Theory.
Yeah, Big Bang Theory is probably the most viewed show in the country.
Speaking of which, why isn't one of those guys a ham? What's wrong with that?
I don't know. Yeah, was there at some point? That's not a show that I get to see, but I think there was a ham radio in the set somewhere.
I don't remember a ham radio episode. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, you know, they should be, and they probably are in some backstory, but no one's ever dealt with it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if we hadn't done the two episodes where Mike Baxter actually got on the radio, everything on our show would just be in the background too. Yeah. So it's very hard to get that content. And you know, that we didn't talk about, why isn't there, people are asking me, why isn't there more ham radio content? And there's two main reasons. One is because nobody in the country knows what ham radio is. And I mean that very seriously, because when we started talking about ham radio with even the cast, crew, and writers, they didn't even come back to me with misconceptions about ham radio. They came back to me with blank stares about ham radio.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is far worse. Right?
So now here toward the end of the show, we're going to talk about some stuff that the folks who have tuned out in the first 15 minutes are going to wish that they stuck around for. Because I want to get your take on the ham radio that appeared in Stranger Things and Frequency. I mean, there's ham radio. The best part of Frequency, I've only watched the first episode, maybe the second episode of Frequency. It's one I'm going to watch when it comes to Netflix or something streaming. But the episode titles are all Inside Baseball Ham Radio.
They are.
Some of them, but I don't remember them, but I remember reading them, and they are pure real ham radio phrases.
I noticed that too, and it surprised me, it's fine, and it surprised me because what they're doing is not ham radio,
of course,
obviously. Yeah. You know, they're doing entirely, like, it's really a police show hung on a sci-fi hook in a way.
Yeah, it's ham radio totally in service to a plot that has, and it started with the movie.
Yeah, and everybody knows, I think, you know, the common ham radio movies, Frequency, Contact, which is probably the best ham radio thing done.
Yeah.
And Phenom or Phenomenon or whatever you want to call it. And there's a bunch.
There's a little bit of ham radio at the beginning of Jericho, but he was the crazy guy.
Right, of course, always.
Stranger Things, which is a Netflix, thought it was going to be a one-shot miniseries, but they got a second season coming. Right. And we'll see if there's any ham radio in that. But they introduced some ham radio into it, and it had a plot point. It wasn't just a background thing. But they did it wrong. You know.
Yeah, because it's generally done wrong.
In service to the story.
Yeah. Yeah, but you know what's funny? It's like, and you mentioned before, police shows and police procedurals, legal shows. Those shows have consultants. I mean, if you watch the credits of a high-profile legal show and certainly a medical show, you'll oftentimes see credits for consultants. And so you'll see a doctor being credited as a consultant for a medical show because they at least minimally wanted to get some of these things right. But in ham radio, they don't seem to care. Like they'll just, like I said once, it's only because I'm there that the ham radio on our show isn't a cardboard box labeled ham radio with blinking lights in it. you know, because that's what it could have been if they or an old big CB radio. Some prop guy would have gone to a prop house and said, I need something that looks like a ham radio. And the prop house would have handed him some box with a lot of knobs and dials and blinking lights on it, because that's generally what happens.
Yeah, it showed up in frequency, or rather in Stranger Things. It was they must have had a consultant, because they did get a real set of radios, some old Heath kits, DX60, HR10, and the HG10 VFO. And spoiler alert, set them on fire. Sorry, guys. But again, in service to the plot, it also showed up in the TV show Limitless for one episode.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
Yeah.
Have you seen the Before Mars episode?
Yeah. I was very disappointed with the way they did ham radio in that. But I'm glad it was there.
I want to know what that radio was.
It was a Sony shortwave receiver.
Okay.
Yeah. So
not with a microphone glued on.
Yeah. Which is what they did in the movie Frequency. They used a Heathkit receiver with a microphone attached to it. I had high hopes when I heard about the ham radio part of Before Mars. And they had a consultant. But once again,
they had NASA. You think they'd have multiple consultants.
Yeah. But once again, it was all in service to the plot. And it was also not produced at the level of the Mars show. It was a prequel sort of thing. I'm glad it existed, and that was one that I think that they could have been taken a bigger cue of real ham radio talking to real space stations, and gotten excitement out of it.
What occurs to me, Gary, is that it's harder to get these things wrong than it is to get them right, because I'm a producer. A producer has to be a bit of a chameleon, all right? I've produced a lot of things that I don't necessarily know about. I mean, I did a whole episode about alcohol-fueled funny car racing. Well, I don't know anything about that, so I had to learn about it. I had to find consultants that could tell me about it. I had to go look at cars and meet people that could explain how that all worked, and I did that. So I guess I could have created an alternate universe of that thing, but that thing really exists, so why wouldn't I just tap into the reality of it? So if I didn't know anything about ham radio as a producer and somebody wrote a story about it, I would at least go online and Google ham radio and probably stumble across the ARRL and, you know, call somebody or ask a question. It's just easier to do the real thing than it is to do the fake thing, I think.
Yeah. But again, you have to produce a show that a mass audience is going to enjoy. And so maybe if there is stereotypes of hams that the public has at least some semblance of beyond the blank stare, you're going to go there. At least initially. Well, we'll see.
I'm going to do what I can. That's all I can do.
Yeah. So is there another ham radio B story in Last Man Standing's future?
There's nothing on the books, although I'm going to start hopefully moving people in the direction. And I've got a couple of writers that I think are sympathetic to the cause.
Yeah. From my perspective, I was thinking, oh, this has some potential just to have, because you established characters as having ham licenses, to have more than just a station in the background. Just, I knew it could never be the thing on the show, but it could be a little thing in the background of the show. And it's never blossomed to more than the...
It's hard.
You would have liked that to happen. You can see how feasible it is.
I would like a little bit of it. It would have to be very, very little, because, as I said, it's the blank stare effect. You are so a script which is about 50 or so pages, and each line is individually numbered. So, you know, there's a couple of thousand lines of dialogue in a script. So the question would be for you, if you're the writer and or you're the executive producer, head writer, what percentage of those lines do you want your audience to not understand?
Yeah.
And so when I certainly get suggestions from hams on emails about, you know, what would be a fantastic ham radio story and I want to say something about that in a minute.
Yeah.
That no one else in the world would know what we're talking about. So probably the network would ask you to edit those out in the first place. They would go, oh, these line 207 through line 215, we don't know what the hell you're talking about. So could you just remove that from the show? You know, unless it got huge laughs, right?
So tell people why they can't send you story ideas, because that's a bad idea.
Yeah, that's a very important idea, because another reason we can't put ham radio stories online, because well-meaning hams have sent us great ideas for ham radio stories. So because of the litigious nature of the society these days, is anything that comes to me as a storyline, having ham radio or not, has to go into an immediate dead file of a story that we will never touch or come anywhere near for fear of being sued by people submitting story ideas.
Yeah. I sent you that story. I want $1 million.
Absolutely. That's exactly right. So, you know, and you would imagine I've gotten through email any number of the stories you can, if you sat here right now for a few minutes, you could think of Mike Baxter's hiking and comes across a stranded hiker and uses ham radio to help save them, or Mike Baxter coordinates emergency during a big fire in Colorado. You can rattle off a dozen storylines that could involve ham radio, and people have. And when they have, that immediately kills that story for all times for our show.
Yeah. So don't do that. probably already screwed it up. There's not going to be very much left. So I'm thinking Tom Clancy, when he writes a book, he teaches you all kinds of things as you're going through the course of that book. I don't know if he's right or not, but you know, half of his book is an instruction manual on some esoteric technology or subject. So how much of your audience sticks with you where you could spoon feed a little bit and let it grow?
Well, I think you probably could do it. I think it would be scary. I think that
scary for you.
Yeah, it would be scary for the writers because, as I say, the writers are judged very harshly on their ability to put a laugh on the page. Yeah. So, you know, the thing is three laughs on a page. So you've got a page of dialogue is X number of seconds of content, and you're going to say, you know, Vanessa says this and Mandy says this and Mike says this, and there's a laugh.
Yeah.
So
Mike saves a hiker in the woods is not a laugh line.
No, Mike getting on the local repeater and giving his call sign, getting the return of a call sign, explaining that there's a downed hiker at such and such a location is six lines of dialogue.
Yeah, no laughs.
That have no laugh in them. Yeah.
Oh, a good writer could find a laugh in there someplace.
Probably a good writer could, but I don't think that there's going to be an episode, as was suggested to me, that there should be an episode where a scene is done entirely in CW.
Really?
No, I don't think that.
although that shirt that has the, I don't know if you saw this, I saw it on Reddit. It's a t-shirt that's out now that says in Morse code, new telegraph, who dis? Are you familiar with the phrase new phone, who dis?
No, I'm not.
It's a thing that I got, I don't know why I know this, but evidently, if you want to, as my wife Cindy explained to it, it is the current generation's talk to the hand. Talk to the hand.
I'm not that hip.
It's like, and now I'll over-explain it with no comedy whatsoever. It's I just got a new phone. I don't have my my call list in it, so your name didn't come up. Yeah, your name didn't come up on my screen. Just your number. I don't know numbers. New phone. Who dis?
Okay. But I get it. But, so you explained it.
But that's the non-funny explanation. The funny explanation is whatever you just said, talk to the hand. I don't care. Yeah. New phone. Yeah. Who dis?
Well, and talk to the hand gets a laugh because it's old now, but it does get a laugh. Yeah.
So at least among hams, and this t-shirt wasn't promoted to hams. I don't know. You know, it's going to be a little esoteric, but it's in Morse code. New telegraph. Who dis?
I think, you know, in the Thanksgiving episode where Mike's on the radio in the basement, it starts at least with he gets a laugh. You know, he asks hams if anybody's out there and nobody comes back, and then he asks if anybody's hiding in their basement, and then he gets a pile up. And
Mike, KA0XTT, just a little shout out. Anybody having a good time here on Thanksgiving? Anybody hiding in their basement to avoid their relatives? One thing I like about these guys, if I don't want to listen to them, I just turn them down like this.
Well, that gets a laugh. So at least we get one laugh based on ham radio.
There we go.
People get to hear that there were like 100 people talking on the ham radio. But then it really just goes into a relatively interesting but not necessarily funny explanation of why Mike Baxter is thankful and likes ham radio. But that's 20 seconds.
Yeah.
30 seconds.
So you can probably get away from the comedy if you go to heartstrings.
Yeah.
For a little while. And that was heartstrings.
Yeah. And I don't know what that scene was like, but I believe that was probably at least 30 seconds.
Yeah.
So that's a huge risk for any comedy to go that long without having a hard laugh in there somewhere.
And as I was watching that, I'm going, well, yeah, I get this. Does the audience. So yeah, I think I recognized your risk. Yeah. There's something else I want to ask about. In both of those episodes, I mean, I'm enough of a media consumer, even though I've worked in the business all my life. I'm enough of a media consumer that I have no trouble slipping into the suspension of disbelief. And I'm watching an episode of Last Man Standing, and these are real people in real situations making me laugh, not actors on a stage. To me, who has spent my life doing media, instantly when the ham radio stuff came on, that went off. These are actors acting ham radio.
Right. Because it's almost impossible to get an actor to understand
how
ham radio is done.
Not because they did anything that that wasn't good acting, that wasn't good program, just because my mind knew this stuff too much.
Sure.
The instant they went to a next scene, right back to I'm living their episode. I'm living their situation. So it was, for me, it was too much familiarity. You must live there all the time.
I totally understand why that would take you and other ham radio operators out of the moment, because they're seeing people that they know aren't hams pretending to use ham radio equipment. But I think for the regular viewer, probably weren't bumped by that so much.
No, I don't think they were at all. I'm just, and I'm wondering how much or how difficult is it for you to analyze how good a production is going to be? Because you can't get any of that, I don't think, anymore, can you?
No, I mean, you have to stay a little distant from it. You have to view it like you're seeing it for the first time. And that, you know, as an editor, and you edit enough to know what that means, it's like I can watch scenes out of sequence and still get a lot of benefit from them, because in my head I'm putting them in sequence.
Yeah.
So it's, we do, not to get too deep into the production, but every week we start on Wednesday morning with a table read, which is the actors reading the scripts to us, the writer, the producers, the writers, the studio, the network, for the very first time. So we're getting sort of the raw, unfiltered, the actors reacting to the scripts as written, without any direction, without any, you know, overthinking about it. So we get a really good sense of how they're feeling about the script and their characters. And then as the week progresses, the director works with them to tweak their performances. But we see a range of their acting. I don't want to say skill, because their skill doesn't change, but their comfort with the material throughout the week. And I think we as producers or creative people in the industry have to keep a fresh eye to make sure that they're doing it in a way that the people that see for the first time will get what's supposed to be going on.
Can you get into the moment, get the suspension of disbelief when you're watching other people's shows or other movies? Do you enjoy them as just an ordinary movie consumer, or are you too much in the whole industry that says, I'm 15 feet farther back and I see the edge of the set?
Mm-hmm. Well, I have to be able to watch it both ways. There's no way to stop yourself. There's no time at which I'm not a producer. You can tell by the amount of emails I sent you and the amount of content and background I sent you, right? So I'm watching it as a viewer, just as a fan of a show, but I can also, you know, I'll look at a special effect and I'll instinctively know how much that cost or how they did it.
Yeah.
There's no way to not know that.
Yeah, you know? In anybody's show. So maybe that comes from working on commercials mostly and not, very, very few broadcast television programs. I get to be the average consumer. Yay. Yay for me.
Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah.
I don't mind. I mean, sometimes I've learned things by watching other people's shows too. You know, it's like something that would be done differently than how I might have thought I would do it, or maybe they spent more money, too much money, or maybe they didn't spend enough, you know, or like, I would never have done it that way because it doesn't look good, you know, or something like that. But I think I'm, when I'm watching it an entertainment program, just trying to be entertained by it.
Yeah. So one last question or topic area, and we'll wrap this up. Have you absorbed much of the homegrown ham radio media, the podcasts and stuff? You've been on almost all of them, so.
Yeah, I made it my business to watch all of them because I wanted to see what was out. I was surprised, first of all, by how much there is. There's a lot.
It's growing fast.
Yeah.
Yeah. When I started, not so much, but there were a couple things. What do you think of it?
I think most of it's pretty good. Luckily, as a consumer of the content, it's different enough to watch more than one. I mean, we can be specific. I mean, your thing does something very specific that I like, and that is, of course, you get very deeply into a topic. So you have like Ham Nation, which is sort of a magazine format show that tends to be very light and deal with, you know, sort of quick topics and pops through. Really, magazine format's the best way to put it. Your show, which and I particularly like the Tapper conferences and the kinds of things that you can do because you will go long form. You're not afraid of actual long content. You're not trying to let's get through this very quickly so we can get to the next thing.
Yeah, and I've got that personality disorder where I don't know what kind of a show I am. Am I a conference show? Am I a talk show? Am I a field production show?
I think that's okay because that just gives you, you don't have to really be any one thing. You just have to provide entertaining content.
Yeah.
So as long as you do that, you're successful. And, you know, there's a number of other like sort of interview shows which tend to be more formulaic and maybe even some that ask the exact same questions to all of their guests. In general,
and a bunch of more technical shows, cause I don't get very technical except for the Tapper conferences.
Yeah. Which, I was surprised. It surprised me how interested I would be in the Tapper conferences, but, that is sort of for me, the fact that ham radio became so, first of all, it maintains its roots on one hand and pushes out into the digital, is one of the things that I found interesting about it. So I'm interested in the Tapper stuff, and that's, you can only really see that content if they put it on YouTube or if you put it on.
Yeah.
So
what I'm thinking is that initially I was disappointed. Most of what we saw was pretty amateurly made, and folks are getting better. They're getting their technology better. We're not seeing very many polished personalities show up, and I don't know whether we need to or not. You know, I like to think I came from those roots and can do a little better job, but I'm not the most popular show out there by far. But, you know, lots of people have it started way after me and have gone far beyond and much faster. So evidently hams aren't interested in something really polished and, you know, personality oriented and smooth. They like someone showing them how to use their radio.
Well, yeah, I mean, I didn't even go there when you said that. I'm not judging it at all in terms of its production value, mm-hmm. only really in terms of its content and if that content is entertaining or interesting. We got through a long interview here and we haven't talked about anything really technological, and most podcasts tend to be, like, if you're not talking about SWR, you're just, there's no point in having the podcast, right?
I've done that show.
Yeah, well, no doubt, but, you know, and that's a valid thing to talk about in amateur radio, but there are some shows that could never get beyond that.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about those six hot button technical issues just rinse and repeat, basically. Yeah.
Quick video editor story you'll probably appreciate. Told me to buy another video editor who, was watching his wife watch a movie on VHS, like third generation with snow and noise and flipping and the bars at the bottom and stuff. And he says, "How can you watch that?" And she says, "I love this movie." Mm-hmm. He says, "Well, yeah, but it's snow and it's flipping and there's bars." And she says, "Only you guys care about that."
That's right.
Content.
Well, content is king. And I think that's true of anything ham radio podcast wise or anything else in general. But I also think it's what I said earlier. It's about making on air ham radio content. And I think the league has done some good things with that, with the Centennial, with the national parks. And, you know, if we're doing anything with the Last Man Standing, we're trying to make 1 hour of fun content on air for ham radio operators to go to. Because that's really what's going to, you know, keep ham radio alive. I mean, the podcasts are interesting for ham radio operators, but non-hams are not going to watch it. And one of the things that I've said, I did a very elaborate, very unfortunate thing. I did a very elaborate forum at the Centennial for the ARRL. And I spent a lot of time and energy putting it together. And it was about presenting amateur radio, mostly to non-hams and to the media. They wouldn't let us record it because there was some union conflict. So it sort of died right there. But the one thing I wanted to say to the people listening was, don't preach to the choir. You know, you can't talk about ham radio to other ham radio operators and expect that that's going to save the hobby, because we're already hams. We already have licenses. We're not adding to the numbers of people on the air. You've got to get the word about radio, whatever that word is. It's fun, it's educational, it's good in emergencies, whatever you want it to be. But you've got to get that word out to non-hams, because talking to each other about ham radio is irrelevant.
So should the ARL produce programs to go out to the general public? Because they don't produce much. They do now and then, but they don't make much.
Yeah, I don't think anybody does. I don't see much. I know there's a couple of promos and things out there. There's some very, very old DVDs that I've seen that were produced by CQ Magazine. But I'm not aware of anything that's being directly produced for the general public that would in any way interest them or entice them into checking out what amateur radio is. So the answer is sure. You know, if they wanted to allocate the resources, yeah, they should totally do that, or somebody should.
Do you by chance remember a shot in those CQ videos where a woman is
bitten by the DX bug?
I think I do. Yeah.
That's my wife. That's okay. Katie for you.
I'm going to, now I have that. See, now I'm going to have to go look at that again, because yeah, I have the,
Oh, it's the best part of the whole, of course, I think it's the best part of the whole, it's the DX video. And they had, it's where I met Rich Moseson. They had been traveling around the country to shoot DXers operating.
It was summertime. There was a solar flare, and we were on the downward slope of the sunspot cycle. To put it simply, HF didn't work.
The best DXers in the world could barely eke out a single contact.
Some days you get skunked.
This is not a good day for DX. The bands are not very good, and he's not even moving the meter.
And they came to our house.
We went to visit Cindy Wood, KD4ACW, who had just upgraded to advanced. Her station? A 50-watt basic radio with no bells or whistles and a dipole antenna in the attic. The big guns were firing blanks that day. What could Cindy hope to do with her little BB gun?
And 20 meters lit up.
Kilo Delta 4, Alpha Charlie Whiskey, Sierra Victor 5, Tango Sierra. Very good evening, 59 on the island of Rhodes, name of Sirius, Victor Alpha.
Those CDs are good. You know, the I've given those. It's very scary to give that CD because it was produced in the 80s, I assume.
90s. Judging, yeah.
90. 90s. Okay, I was just judging by the hairstyles. I was going to say the 80s.
Well, it was hams, of course.
Oh, my God. And I can't go into anything specific about it, but because I think that they're, in general, they're great because the information is perfect.
Yeah.
But, of course, they're very dated. So you can't really show them. I would like to use those as instructional for, like, my people that are trying to get ham licenses. I've made, you know, I've shown some of that content to those kids, but it's hard because you can't show a 20-something today here in the 2017s, something produced in the late 80s or 90s, because they just completely discounted immediately just looking at the, you know, the hairstyles and the, I just remember who was the, one of the ladies who had the giant big round glasses.
I don't remember who that was, but yeah. Although those are probably coming, they've probably come and gone three or four times.
They probably have, but I haven't been using those DVDs as instructional. But the content in them is absolutely valid today. There's nothing about the technology has changed.
Yeah. So I'm thinking I think we could use better media aimed at us. And I kind of hoped that I would be able to do it, and I come as close as I can. But it's, you know, one person's shoestring budget. And I've talked to PR people at the league, and they don't really have the budget, but I also think that hams don't have the vision. They don't absorb it. We are anachronistic for forward thinking technology. People were anachronistic in our media, and I'm just going to have to accept that.
Yeah. There's also, you know, there's resistance, even internally. You would say, well, don't you think we need to make lots of new hams? And there'd be a segment of the ham radio population that would disagree with you and say, no, it's perfect just the way it is right now. In fact, there's too many people on the air, you know.
Well, yeah, that is true. And although something I haven't been able to wrap my mind about, when I got licensed in 1965, there were about 350,000 hams. Now there's more than twice that. And back then with that many hams, there was a ham store in every town and things were booming. And now with this many hams, we're limping along. So you do the money stuff. You understand that better than I do. Yeah. And audiences and things.
You know, I floated one thing out to, and now I've been fortunate enough to meet a lot of the people in the ham radio industry through the show, and especially manufacturing representative types, you know, and I've floated the idea that there could be some coalition, you know, if the major manufacturers were willing to speak to one another, which I don't know that they are, that maybe they could all sit in a room and say, you know, I'd be willing to put up X number of dollars, and I'd be willing to put up X number of dollars, and we could come up with a small budget, and maybe we could hire some professionals, and we could produce some content that might make non-hams interested in ham radio. But I don't think there's a lot of intercompany cooperation between, you know, there's a lot of competition. It's VHS versus beta, and they don't want to, but it would be like, I likened it to the Got Milk, you know, the Got Milk ads, which everybody knows. That was done by a consortium of basically milk producers, and they were competitors with one another, but they all put money into a pool, came up with a fund, and created the Got Milk ad. So it needs to be the equivalent of that that kind of a cooperative, collaborative arrangement between manufacturers, but I don't think that may not happen.
ICOM has produced more than anybody else, but they've been in fits and starts. They started a little bit of outreach and then stopped, probably when they saw how much it costs to do. Well, it's getting cheaper and cheaper to do all the time.
Absolutely.
All right. I have held you like way longer than I ever expected to. And
that's quite right.
planted in front of your last man standing sign. There it is.
This is going to make, when you edit this, it's going to make a great 10-minute segment.
The only thing that I'm planning on editing out is the couple of times when Skype just absolutely upchucked and froze you for a long time and couldn't even hear anything. That's about all I'm going to take out. I usually leave
everything. We didn't say anything too embarrassing. So.
No, we're pretty good shape. So, but thank you very much for coming on the show. I will, I'll do my wrap up later on. We'll take care of this stuff. And I won't even make you say over and out unless you want to.
Oh, I lived in fear of that.
Yeah. Oh, in that case, I'll do the wrap up of the show right here. Behind me, that's Arvin sitting back there. He controls the finances. You control the finances on your show, right?
I do.
Yeah. So you know what Arvin's job is. He's chief financial officer. So he's inviting you to stop by hamradionow.tv, make a contribution. It's been pretty good. Lots of, I'm not retiring off of this, but it does a little bit more than dribbling in. So I really want to thank you guys that do that. Hamradionow.tv. And now the world famous John Amodeo, NN6JA, producer, executive producer of Last Man's co-executive producer.
Yeah, don't get me in trouble.
Who's the other guy? Or how many?
Oh, there's 12 of them.
Yeah. So that's an honorific for some people, right?
Yeah.
But sometimes it's a real job.
It's absolutely a real job for many people. And it is that's a whole other topic. The producing title is not protected. To be a writer, you have to be in the Writers Guild and be a writer. To be a director, you have to be in the Directors and be a director. To be a producer, someone has to give you the producing title.
Anybody can be a producer.
Anybody
can play. Yeah. That is it for this episode of Ham Radio. Now you are
John Amodeo, NN6JA.
I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, 73, everybody, over.
And out.
He's watched the end of a show. I'm so impressed.